law maker Archana Joshi. With her, I worked for maternity leave of 6 months. Now it is a law. So she is a lawmaker. We are pediatricians at Virar. She is 67 and runs corporation's COVID fever clinics, not worried about getting infected. Now I am going to tell you a small story. How this law of maternity plus breastfeeding leave came into existence. In 1988, we were at Ahmednagar with Dr. R.K. Anand, Dr. Raj Anand, the grandfather of breastfeeding movement of India. At midnight, 11 to 11:30, we were at the Ahmednagar railway station waiting for a train and discussing India's breastfeeding problems. So a thought came that if maternity leave is 6 months, then all mothers can feed a baby for 6 months. And this will avoid 1500 deaths daily at zero cost and make every baby better. So we decided to work for it. We printed leaflets in Hindi, English, Marathi and gave them to everyone and forever to give in his office or her office to their union. Late Central Minister Vasant Sathe had told me that national doctors body should make recommendations, then government will take. So we proposed that Indian Academy of Pediatrics should recommend maternity leave of 6 months. IAP studied our proposal for a year and passed it unanimously in January 1992. And within 1 week, Punjab and Haryana state governments gave maternity leave of 6 months. Times of India gave, LIC gave, Railways gave, and this kept on happening. We met every possible important person. We met few chief ministers. There was a 6 chief ministers meeting in Mumbai. So we met them. I was in Chennai. So I went to Jayalalitha's place. That was election time. She was not there. But I left letter and literature for her. I went to Calcutta. I went to Mamata Banerjee's place. That was election time. Could not meet her, but left literature and letter. They won within 2 weeks, and after a week of taking office, both of them granted maternity leave of 6 months. Then all the unions in all offices kept asking for 6 months leave. Central government first gave 4.5 months leave, then made it 6 months. And this government passed a law. Now every private and government employee gets maternity leave. The lesson is, simple people, we are simple people. If we think of a good thing, work selflessly for a lifetime, things do happen. Don't leave everything for Prime Minister. Do it ourselves. So now I ask Dr. Archana Joshi to take over.
Thank you, Heman. I start my... Good evening, everybody. Many thanks for joining us on this webinar. The topic is very simple: breastfeeding, its problems and solutions. But the incidence of breastfeeding is going down. So we need to emphasize more on breastfeeding. What's happening? Okay, there's something wrong with my slides. I can't do it. I can't move also. Yeah. Can I just
check click on enable content first?
Yeah.
Click on enable content.
Ma'am, you can put it in presentation mode. You need to share your screen.
Anjali, can you start your presentation? Archana will follow you. Got it. Okay.
Got it. I got my slides.
Yes.
Yeah. Anjali, I'm starting.
Yes, ma'am. Record. Yeah.
We start with breastfeeding. It's a simple topic, but it has become difficult because of urbanization. So there are three steps in successful breastfeeding. First is successful initiation of mother's milk. Second is good milk feeding up to 1 to 2 years. And third is successful happy switchover to home food. In India, majority, including doctors, have problems with all the three steps. So this webinar, even though everybody feels it's a very simple topic, we need to tell this to all our parents. And now all of us, six of us, will tell you what to tell and how to tell in simple language. All of us will see that the language is simple and not very complicated to make it easy for the mothers to understand. If a newborn baby could talk, he would say, breastfeeding is my birthright and my pediatrician or my doctor should fight for it. So we should all fight for the rights of our baby. This is a poster showing a real mother, that's our own mother, a stepmother, that is a cow or a buffalo, and the demon mother, that is our bottle feeding. It has it poisons all our babies, makes them fall sick, and causes a lot of mortality in patients. So we need to get rid of this bottle feeding. This is New Zealand's Prime Minister, Dr. Jacinda Ardern. She's feeding her baby and speaking in the parliament. She looks happy, proud, and confident. We must ensure that every mother becomes like this. She's able to feed in public and she's confident about it. She should not feel shy about feeding. So the objectives of this webinar are to increase awareness about breastfeeding, to educate about the benefits of breastfeeding, to educate about the basics of breastfeeding. Recommendations are early initiation as at birth and exclusive breastfeeding until 6 months of age and introduction of complementary food with continuation of breastfeeding. And we should continue to breastfeed for 2 years or longer. The advantages of breastfeeding are advantages to the baby. It is a complete food. It is specific. It is easily digested and well absorbed. It protects against infection. It promotes emotional bonding and it causes better brain growth. Coming to the advantages to the baby, it helps in involution of uterus, it delays pregnancy, it lowers the risk of breast and ovarian cancer, and it decreases mother's workload. Benefits to the family are there. It saves money, it promotes family planning, it decreases the need of hospitalization, and it contributes to child survival, which is very important. Breastfeeding has immunological specificity. It provides protection against pathogens and allergens. It kills pathogenic organisms or modifies their growth. It stimulates epithelial maturation for future defense. It gives protection against common respiratory and intestinal diseases. Other immunological specificities are that colostrum is the first vaccination a baby receives from his mother. And we should see that all babies get colostrum even if the mother has undergone a cesarean section. It reduces the risk of illnesses like ear infections, pneumonia, Crohn's disease, other bowel illnesses, allergies, asthma, and eczema. It is a perfect food for the babies. It is just the right amount and has the right nutrients in right proportions. The composition of breast milk shows it has live cells, fats, carbohydrates, proteins, vitamins, minerals. It has less fat as compared to most other mammals, and it has more lactose than other mammals. There are some successful tips for breastfeeding. We should do antenatal counseling of all the mothers, especially the primary mothers. We should check the breast for nipples and check if they are small or they are retracted nipples. We should teach them proper positioning of the baby while feeding. And we should tell them about early initiation of breastfeeding. and there should be no bottle feeding at any point of time. There should be no negative marks either. Never say your nipple is small, you have got a small breast, you will not get milk, you look tired, etc. There should be no pre-lacteal feeds because they replace milk and they reduce baby's desire to breastfeed. They also give infection and cause allergy to the babies. There should be no pacifiers, no bottles, no artificial teats because it leads to nipple confusion. We should say a big no to all the market products. We should tell all that milk production does not depend on the size of the breast. Big size is due to fat and supporting tissues. All mothers make adequate milk for their babies. Lactating mother need not avoid some food. She can have all the food which a family eats. Mothers need not sit to breastfeed. They can feed the baby in any comfortable position. They need not feed on both sides at every time. When the baby cries, it does not mean that milk is less. Baby will more often quieten down on picking up or on changing the nappy. Why do we stress on early initiation of breastfeeding at birth? Because it is that time when the baby is very active. It leads to early bonding between mother and the baby. There is successful establishment of breastfeeding. The letdown reflex starts and the meconium also passes out very easily. How can we help these mothers now? We should inform the mothers about advantages. We should not separate the mother and the baby. Rooming in should be practiced. We should avoid unnecessary shifting to the NICU, and we should do maximum mother to child contact, including kangaroo mother care. And we should avoid any negative marks. We should always keep on encouraging this new mother. This is a diagram of the breast tissue, wherein we can see that the breast glands, they secrete milk, and through these ducts, it is collected in the lacticiferous sinuses here, which is below the areola. And when the baby presses on this areola, the milk comes out. This is the correct position of sucking at the breast. You can see the whole of the areola is inside baby's mouth. You can see the nipple pressing against the hard palate and helping the baby to squeeze the milk. This is baby opening with his full mouth open to latch at the breast. You can see whole of the brown portion has gone inside the baby's mouth. This is the proper latching and baby will get sufficient milk if he holds like this. This is a wrong position when you can see whole of the areola is outside and only baby's nipple sucking. So baby mother will get sore nipples and will do more harm than good. Talking about the positions for breastfeeding, this is the commonest position. It is cradle hold position. The infant's head is supported in the elbow, the back and the buttock is supported by the arm, and baby is lifted to the breast. The football hold position. In this position, the infant is placed under the arm like holding a football. The baby's body is supported with the forearm and the head is supported with the hand. Many mothers are not comfortable in this position. Although we recommend this position, feeding two babies at a time, in case of twin deliveries. This is a good position after operative procedures. Side lying position. The mother lies on her side, propping up her head and shoulder with pillow. The infant is also lying down facing the mother. It is a good position after cesarean section. It allows the new mother to take some rest, but most mothers are scared that they might crush the baby or they might go to sleep. The cross cradle position. This is ideal for early breastfeeding. The mother holds the baby crosswise in a crook of the arm opposite the breast the infant is to be fed. The baby's trunk and head are supported with forearm and palm. The other hand is placed beneath the breast in a U shape to guide the baby's mouth to the breast. Burping is very important during and after feeding to bring up any excess air that was taken in during feeding. The baby should be burped after every feeding or between the breast change. Signs of effective breastfeeding. All babies should be fed at least 8 to 10 times in a day. The infant should have about 6 to 8 wet diapers in 24 hours once the breastfeeding is established. the infant should have minimum of 3 to 4 bowel movements every 24 hours. And the stool should be about 1 tablespoon or a larger and should be soft and yellow after day 3. The average daily weight gain should be about 15 to 30 grams. And the infant usually gains his birth weight by 10th day of life. We should continue to breastfeed our babies for 2 years, provided the baby is taking adequate solid food. Some common queries which often the nursing mothers face. They are, does my baby need extra water? The answer is no. Does the baby need extra food like jaggery or honey? The answer again is no. Does the baby need herbal tonics, tonics or multivitamins? The answer again is no. Does the baby need supplementary milk? Again, we need to reassure the mother, there is no need of supplementary milk. So the answer to all these questions is a big no. If a baby wets 8 to 10 nappies and passes urine like we see in this diagram, we don't need to give any supplementary feeds to these babies. The breast milk is adequate for these babies. Now, the common problems encountered in mother during breastfeeding. Some mothers have cracked or sore nipples. That is because of difficulty in latching. So for correction, we need to tell them that the whole areola should go into the baby's mouth. There should be proper latching. The baby should be frequently fed. And there should be rotation of the breast during breastfeeding. The nipple should be air dried and warm soak should be given. For flat or retracted nipples, we need to use electric pumps or syringe method. When we take a 20cc syringe, we cut it along this nozzle, pull out the piston and put it from the other end. And the flat of the syringe is kept on the nip on the areola and we can pull the nipple out. This is done about 10 to 12 times in 24 hours. Now, expression of breast milk. When it is needed, we need to express milk when our baby is in NICU or baby is too sick to suck the milk directly from the breast. How do we do that? We first wash our hands with soap and water. Have a clean container below the breast to collect the milk. Massage the breast gently towards the nipple. Place the thumb and index finger opposite each other just outside the areola and press towards the chest and gently squeeze to express the milk. This step is repeated at 5 different positions around areola and this milk which is withdrawn can be given with vati and spoon. This is another method of expressing milk. This is a breast pump method when we can use a pump to extract milk. There's also a warm water method in which an empty bottle is warmed up, held with a cloth and brought it next to the areola. As the bottle cools, a vacuum is created and the milk is sucked inside the bottle. This can be used to express the breast milk. And the baby is thus fed with a vati spoon or bonla or palada or gokarna as it is called. Thank you. I now hand over the mic to my next speaker, Dr. Anjali Gokarna. Dr. Anjali, are you online?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Yes, I'll just share my screen.
Yeah.
Thank you, Archana. It was a wonderful talk. You spoke and covered most of the things that are important. Can you hear me, Archana?
Yeah, Anjali, I can hear.
Yeah. And thank you, Hemant, for the wonderful opening. Can you see my slides?
Yes, Anjali, we are seeing them. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. We are in very, very unusual times. We are in Corona times. We are in COVID times. And like everything is different, what about breastfeeding? Is it also different during these times? This is what we are going to see now. So we know, like Archana said, that breastfeeding, of course, is the best start in life. It benefits both mothers, families, and children. And it's a sustainable food system. And of course, she told us the guidelines, begin within 1 hour for 6 hours. Months. and complementary feedings, and we have to continue for 2 years. I won't tell you the advantages again, which Archana has told us so well, but I'll definitely tell you the advantages in these difficult times. We all know that these are economically strained and a very, very, strained times for all of us. So spending on formula or any other kind of feed except breast milk, of course, will cost us money. So breastfeeding will save us this expenses. We have to travel to buy formula, to buy the milk and all the things that are needed to feed the formula. So travel, you know, these days is difficult. So breastfeeding saves you the trouble of traveling. Also, when you go out, you are exposed, you are at risk. You are at risk from touching contaminated surfaces, and you're going to get those contaminated surfaces home. So breastfeeding avoids this risk of exposure and contamination. Then, of course, if you are breastfeeding, you don't have to violate any curfew. You don't have to go out of your containment zone. There is no need for an e-pass, and of course, no need for a QR.
Good.
It has various other immunological advantages, like Archana told us. It has several bioactive molecules, IgG, IgA. It contains several antiviral properties, which is very important at this stage, because it contains something called human milk oligosaccharide. And this is something that is, you know, generally something that will protect against viral infections. But there is one study specifically that has showed that there are secretory IgA antibodies against COVID. This is the only one reference I found. They haven't yet found whether it is really very protective, but this is something encouraging. Just like after SARS in 2004, there were immunoglobulins to the SARS coronavirus at that time. And also, breast milk is known to contain RSV antibodies. So there are several antibodies, immunological, bioactive molecules, as well as there are specific IgA antibodies which are coming up now against COVID. And of course, the slogan for this year, you know, is that support breastfeeding for a safer planet. So in COVID times, we are all, sort of drowning under disposables like gowns and PPE kits and masks and gloves. So here, we are not using any of them. We are saving our resources like water, we have plastic. We are not using fuel for traveling to get the outside milk. We are not using fuel to warm the milk or water. And of course, there is no deforestation for dairy farming. So breastfeeding in every way is eco-friendly, especially now in COVID times with so many disposables. But we are really worried about COVID positive or COVID infected mothers. These are the mothers we are really wondering what to do. I know of two instances, one in which a COVID hospital, which is nearby where I stay in Vasai, where COVID mothers had delivered, all of them were giving formula. And it was only at the intervention of the pediatrician over there when they started breastfeeding. So even obstetricians don't know that breastfeeding is the best. Another instance, a 5-month-old patient of mine, her mother rang me up saying that myself and my husband have tested COVID positive. I'm staying at my mother's place and the baby is at his mother's place. And what milk should I give now? So I was shocked. I said, doesn't she know that breast milk is the best? So I told her, if you're asymptomatic, you should feed. So she said, no, but my in-laws won't allow me. And my family physician has also said that since you're COVID positive, you can't feed. So that is the, extent of ignorance that is there in the society. So let us now go through what actually happens in a COVID positive mother. So there could be perinatal transmission, of course. And perinatal transmission can occur in two ways. One is vertical transmission and one is horizontal transmission. So vertical transmission, we mean the virus is passed on from the mother through her breast milk into the baby. And horizontal transmission would mean that the mother transmits her infection via respiratory droplets, not through breast milk. So breastfeeding would, transmit it vertically or horizontally. So let us look at what is the evidence that is present for vertical transmission. several studies initially showed that there was no transmission through breast milk, but there was a study which was done in New York, and they showed two mothers who were COVID positive had RNA particles of COVID in their breast milk. And of those two, one of them developed respiratory infection and tested positive, and one of them was absolutely all right. So this was one of the evidence, but two patients is really nothing much. And thereafter, there's another very good paper that came from the WHO itself, where they had, sort of examined four centers which had tested 46 dyads. That means 46 pairs of mother and newborn. And they found out of the 46, 43 had no viral particles in their breast milk, whereas three of them had the virus particles. Of the three, the two newborns did not develop any respiratory infection, and one of them did. But in that one child whose mother did have the viral particle in the breast milk, they didn't know whether there was some other contact who had an infection and had transmitted the infection. Here, I'd also like to say that, the demonstration of viral particle in the breast milk doesn't necessarily mean that it is an infective particle. It could just mean that it is the RNA of the virus. And in past experience, there have been papers in the MERS pandemic and the SARS pandemic that occurred in 2003, where they showed that there was very little transmission through breast milk. So perhaps we can go by that experience. Yeah, and also it has been seen that respiratory viruses like influenza and others show very little transmission through breast milk. So yes, there is some evidence of vertical transmission, but it is a very low percentage. What about the evidence on horizontal transmission? We know that that is the primary route, through respiratory route, that this infection spreads. So infection transmission through respiratory droplets is established. But what about mothers then? So there's a lovely study in The Lancet published in the month of July, end 24th of July, in which they studied 116 mothers. The deliveries of 1,500 mothers was tested. And of that, 116 mothers were found to be COVID positive. They tested all these infants. There were 120 children, so some were twins, of course. And all these 120 were negative at 24 hours. That means none of them had the vertical transmission transplacentally. So when they tested these babies at 24 hours, if they were negative, that means whatever happened thereafter would have been the perinatal transmission. And when they tested some of them. Now, of the 120, all of them didn't come for follow-up. 80 of them did. And they found all of them were negative at 5 to 7 days. Then some of them came back on after 14 days. They were also negative. And all of them were followed up by follow-up at 1 month, and all of them were negative. So this is something that we have to, but what are the things they did? So these all mothers were allowed to, room in with their babies. The babies were kept a little far and were kept in covered cribs. They were allowed to directly breastfeed with good hand sanitization and good hand hygiene and wearing masks and sanitizing all the surfaces that were there. So these were the precautions that they took. So the conclusion from the evidence of horizontal transmission says that it is safe when infection prevention and control measures are taken. There would be very little transmission from COVID positive mothers to their children. Even if we know that there is some chance that the virus could be passed through breast milk, like in the vertical transmission, there are several disadvantages of not breastfeeding. And this is amply proved many times. And this study where in 2015, they found that in India, several centers had a mortality of more than 14 times that of children who were breastfed. So that's a lot. So the advantages of not breastfeeding have to be very strongly weighed against the disadvantages of not breastfeeding. And it's from these that the WHO, the BPNI, and the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare have made their guidelines. And these are the guidelines that we are following. And what are the guidelines? Early skin to skin, delayed cord clamping, rooming in, kangaroo mother care, infection prevention and control measures, and breastfeeding. So this is, so don't separate the mother and do all these things. This is what the WHO, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare is telling us. So there is a decision tree. I don't know, most of you must have seen this, or I'll be very happy to share this decision tree, which is nothing but an algorithm which tells us how to go about managing such a patient. But basically it tells us how to manage when a mother is positive and asymptomatic, when she's mildly ill, and when she's severely ill. So when a mother is asymptomatic, don't separate the mother and child. She can room in with the baby. She can have early skin-to-skin contact, KMC, when it's needed. And all this is being done at our Nair Hospital, which has the highest and the maximum number of... I spoke to one of the colleagues who's there, and she said, we've had 550 mothers. And we haven't... She didn't give me any... there is no data which is published. They all have it. But she didn't tell me the exact figures, but she said that this is what we practice. And... It's recommended to have direct breastfeeding with infection prevention control measures like wearing a mask, a hand wash before every feed. Wash the chest if she has coughed on it. She need not wash her breast every time. And she has to sanitize the surfaces she has touched and which are likely to touch the baby. If the mother is moderately ill, like she's breathless or on oxygen, what do? You keep the baby separate. Ask the mother to wear a mask, wash her hands well, express the breast milk, like Archana said, either with a breast pump or manually. A clean pump has to be used every time, and it has to be sterilized by the standard sterilization procedures. The container has to be cleaned by the mother and handled by a masked and gloved attendant. Also, this milk has to be then fed by vati spoon or bondla or a gokan, like Archana said, by a healthy caregiver. What if the mother is not able to express breast milk? Well, there I think Jayashree will come to our help with human milk banking. So when is a mother not able to even express breast milk? If she's coughing too much, or if she's in ICU, or she's too weak. At such times, we can give bank donor human milk if it's available, or other alternatives, wet nursing can be practiced, or we can give formula or any other animal milk. But important to remember that after the mother recovers, we have to help her to relactate. Now, after the mother has recovered, and if she's not able to relactate, then we can take the help of lactation counselors, which Dr. Prashant Gangal has trained so many of them. We can take the help of other mother support groups, or then we can counsel other safe methods of feeding, the correct way of preparing a formula, the correct way of sterilizing all the equipments that are going to feed the baby. So till when does a mother have to, practice the infection prevention and control measures? When will you say a mother is non-infectious? So at least 10 days since the first onset of her symptoms, up to 20 days if she has had more severe to critical illness or is immunocompromised, and 24 hours have passed since her last fever without the use of antipyretics, and all her other symptoms have improved. What are the infection prevention and control measures? If we just tell the mother, wear a mask and clean your hands, is that enough? No, we have to tell her correctly what type of mask to use. So the best thing would be to ask her to wear a double-layered cloth mask, which we are giving our patients, which can be washed well and used for a long time. Or if she likes to use a surgical triple-layer mask, it has to be disposed of and a new one used daily. We have to also tell her the correct way of tying the mask. It has to cover her nose and chin, and one above the ear and one tie below the ear. We have to teach her the correct way of hand wash and tell her she has to wash her hands with good soap for 40 seconds in a 6-step method. And we have to teach her that she has to clean surfaces with hypochlorite solution, that is 0.05%, 0.5%, and how she has to make it with bleaching powder and water. What about baby care? There have been many WhatsApp and lovely messages with babies wearing a plastic shield, but please, they are not recommended. Plastic infant face shields are not recommended. There were some WhatsApp which you were showing them even in the NICU, but they are not recommended. And masks should not be placed on neonates or on children younger than 2 years. So what is the role of healthcare workers in COVID times for breastfeeding? Counsel mothers and families. Tell them about the low risk of transmission. Tell them about the immune factors in breast milk, the signs of infections in baby, what to look out for. Tell them they can re-lactate after recovery and help them to do that. Teach families, mothers, the proper mask use, proper hand wash and hand hygiene techniques, and how to take care of contaminated surfaces. So to wrap up, there is a small risk of virus transmission through breast milk and respiratory droplets, but the disadvantages of not feeding are far more. So it is definitely advantageous to breastfeed the baby. Breast milk is safe, economical, full of immune factors, and start feeding within 1 hour exclusively for 6 months with complementary feeds for 2 years. In COVID positive mothers, you can start early skin to skin care. We can practice delayed cord clamping, rooming in, kangaroo mother care, IPC measures, and direct breastfeeding. If direct feeding is not possible, then express milk. If even that is not possible, donated human milk or formula. And definitely for the last two kinds, re-lactation after recovery. So breastfeeding is the best feeding, and in keeping with the slogan of 2020, we have to support breastfeeding for a healthier planet, to have happy babies, happy mothers, happy families, and a fantastic earth. Thank you.
Thank you, Anjali, for this wonderful lecture. All of us have learned a lot from you, and we'll all support breastfeeding even in Corona times. Okay. Now I invite Dr. Hemant Joshi, who's going to talk on new ideas in breastfeeding.
Yeah. Namaste. The first new idea is tell stories, songs, laugh and enjoy your talk and let everybody be happy. So I'm going to tell you only happy stories, and they will carry the message. We have lots of books which we can share with you and videos in many languages. So just WhatsApp your name to me on 98-232-81-447 or send me a mail on haj2007@gmail.com. Or we have a free 12 language childcare website where the books are there. You can see it on the net. You can write my name on internet and you will see the website. Like, for example, this book, Happy Child Feeding, 6 months onwards. Why this book? Because the whole world is teaching breastfeeding, but the switchover from breast milk to home food fails in 90% Indian houses, and we make small children. Why should we tell all about child feeding? Because we have shrunken ourselves and our kids. Our genes are same. Still, we are 1 foot short than Europeans with smaller muscles and a smaller brain. See, you can see in that photo, me and a friend and a European friend. With better care, we will make younger generation taller, smarter. A wrong start of mother's milk and wrong home food thereafter in 90% homes is our tragedy. And we can change it today. You see how it happens. Our brain grows and then our head grows. Small head means small brain. To measure brain, we measure head size, head circumference. Newborns weighing 3.75 kilos in India and US, they have same head size, 39 centimeters. I'm telling you after studies. At 1 year, head of an Indian baby is 46.5 centimeters, 2.5 centimeters less, 1 inch less than a US baby. So we make our brains smaller in first year. In first year alone, we destroy our young generation, and this cannot be changed later on. So let's feed them well in first year. These babies' breasts were squeezed. Baby got abscess. Baby can die. Baby may recover, but the breast is destroyed. And every family does this. Let us not do this, because every 17th mother cannot feed the baby because of damaged nipple, retracted nipple, or a flat nipple. We cause this. I studied all animals over 30 years. No animal has such problem. This is a man-made problem. Let us stop it. Let us tell this to all. How to tell? Ram killed Ravan. He took help of monkeys. Did he tell them in English how to fight? No. He must have used a language that monkeys understand. We have to tell about feeding to all parents, staffs, colleagues, and the children. We need to talk in our languages. And we have 1600 Indian spoken languages. So let us put all this knowledge into our language, all this knowledge into our languages, and share it with all by WhatsApp, Facebook. By tomorrow night, India should be better if we all do this. So let us do this. Every third tiny baby is a small baby, and this baby gets a problem. Newborn must get breast milk before crying every time. That prevents brain damage. Why this is important? When a tiny baby does not get breast milk immediately when needed, baby's blood sugar drops and the brain gets damaged. Later, they become dull people. Vision is affected. They need specs. They get fits, and some die daily. Avoid this as follows. Tiny baby should not be needed to cry for milk. Ask mother to tie him in a cloth and tie it to herself so that the baby opens the mouth and gets milk. And then we will have reduced child deaths and all intelligent kids who have grown well. You can take a sari, wrap it around yourself, and put your baby in that. Go on internet and see for sari baby wrap, and you will see videos. I will tell you a Krishna Katha. Next week is Janmashtami. Just reach Krishna Katha to all houses, and all our children will grow well and happy, starting from our own family. Krishna's mother was in jail. He got Yashoda's milk, not cow milk. Nanda had 10,000 cows. Still, Krishna got Yashoda's milk. No bottle feeding. So let's promote breast milk banking, means giving one mother's milk to another mother's baby. Sambhaji was Shivaji's son. His mother died when he was 3 months. He drank another mother's milk, Dudma, wet nurse. Premchand has a story, Dood Ka Karsh. Do read that story. My friend Dr. Arif Ahmed from Hyderabad phoned me and said, Prophet Muhammad drank his mother's milk and milk of one more auntie. So we must promote this all. We boil milk at home. That is pasteurization. Because we do not know pasteurization, we don't have machines to pasteurize, we don't make breast milk banks. The reason is that we do not know that boiling milk is pasteurization. When we heat the milk, the germs are destroyed. Then you keep it in fridge and it remains good for a long time. In freezer, it remains good for months. But because we do not know that pasteurization is just heating and cooling the milk, we are not having breast milk bank in every home. We can have a breast milk bank in every home. If a mother is not having enough milk, she can give another mother's milk to her baby. And in Brazil, every second baby gets own mother's milk and another mother's milk. If all mothers are healthy, you have to do nothing. Just take out milk and give. But if a mother is, if you are worried that if the milk, whether the milk will give illness, just take water in a container, and in that you put containers having milk and boil the water. The milk gets sterilized. Cover the tins and keep them in fridge and use any time. Even office going mother, women can take out milk and keep them in the fridge. Putana Mausi had gone to kill child Lord Krishna. He killed her. Feeding bottle is the new Putana Mausi. Put her in Holi. We did this in Virar and they did it in Gandhidham. Dr. Thakkar did it in Gandhidham. You do this and Lord Krishna will bless you. On day 5, they put a kardhani, a waist thread, kardoda or kandoro around waist of child Krishna. This is the best, most sensitive growth monitor known to everybody. When the thread becomes loose, the grandmother understands child is becoming weak. He is not getting enough food. And when it becomes tight, she understands that my child is growing well. We should give one to son-in-law in marriage so that he does not become obese. It is good for everybody. India has 16 samskars. Son is good, kar is karya. We do only 2. One is marriage and another is after death. And others we have forgotten. So annaprashanam samskar is done at 6 months. At 6 months, smear the lips of the baby with home food. He licks it with tongue and then start all the food. In my hospital, our Lord Child Krishna is God of my hospital. We make shira, prasadam, every morning and every evening fresh. And it is given to every child and every family. And any child who has completed 6 months, we do his annaprashanam publicly every day in my clinic and ask them to teach it to the whole country. You also do this. And we have videoed it in all languages, many, many languages. And add mother's milk to whatever a baby eats. When we add mother's milk, the baby takes the food or the medicine better. Kanhaiya was makhan chore. It tells me that we keep food beyond the reach of children, so they are malnourished. Have a kid food corner. Keep food on the ground so that children can just go and eat. Keep water there so that they don't become thirsty. Another issue. There is a National Institute of Nutrition at Hyderabad. They have a National Nutrition Monitoring Bureau. It says 90% of weak Indian children, correction, it shows that, the studies show that in weak Indian children, there is a deficit of 90% in oil intake. Means our weak children get in less oil. So add a spoon of oil to every weak child's food and he will put on weight faster. Then Krishna is Laddu Gopal. So he has a snack in hand. So if we have laddus with our kids, they will never become malnourished. In Satyanarayan Puja, we have Lord Krishna there. We give sira and fruits. Give it to our child who is our Lord Krishna. Ashwatthama from Mahabharata is immortal. His poor father could not give him cow milk. He grew on rice and dal. Tell this to everybody. Those who don't afford cow milk, don't worry. Their child will become immortal. Give all home food. Lord Child Krishna is God of Jagannath Puri. We give him 6 lunches and 56 snacks daily. Do this to our kids and there will be no malnutrition. Not for fat children. So there are 5 ways of giving food to prevent malnutrition and treat malnutrition. Have a garland of snacks, fruits. Have a purse, transparent bag with snacks. Keep it in their pockets. Give a transparent jar with snacks. Keep it in the corner. Also give water. And let half of them be greens, pomegranate seeds and such things. Faulty feeding in first year leads to smaller brains and malnutrition. And it is never corrected. So do a bent spoon test. Take a spoon, take baby's food, bend it. If it spills, it has more water. It will starve your child. It should never spill. Tell this to all. And one who takes a lot of water, he passes urine, he gets constipated. He cries a lot because he is hungry. He starves, becomes weak, becomes white. anemia. And then he gets constipated, and the hard stools, when they come out, they cause fissure. They hurt the anus, and the fissure pains, and defecation stops. This photo shows a fissure at the anus. And there is a cream called as Prelox. If you just put a layer at the anus, it creates painlessness for a depth of 1 centimeter for 1 hour or 2 hours. And the child passes motions. The train of baby feeding should go from mother's milk to home food comfortably without accidents. This does not happen in 90% homes. So let's see how to do it. I'm telling you a story. The tiny baby on the lap is a 1.5 kilo, 2.5 months old baby. Mother died during delivery of jaundice, and this auntie did not have food for herself. She would take a vati of milk and a glass of water and feed. And she had no money for herself. So I just made her this 1.5 month baby. I made her sit on the lap and smeared her the lips with Shira, which we have. And the child licked it with the tongue and ate it. I told her, stop milk, give her home food, make her sit on the lap and smear her lips with rice and dal and whatever you eat. And today the child is doing BCom and is 5'3". He has grown well. Last 23 years, we have introduced home food to babies sitting on mother's lap like this with zero problem. And we have no failures. Constipation is biggest problem of the world because of wrong feeding in first year and onwards. So I'm telling you a poem, a song. It's based on Call the Doctor Just Now. I drank milk, I drank juice, I drank liquids just now. Stomach paining, stomach paining, stomach paining just now. Call the doctor, call the doctor, call the doctor just now. Constipation, constipation, constipation just now. Stop liquid foods, stop cow milk, stop juices just now. Give solid food, give home food, give all food just now. No constipation, no constipation, no constipation just now. Thank you, doctor. Thank you, doctor. Thank you, doctor, just now. Then many malnourished mothers complain of decline in lactation. So we weigh lactating mothers every month when she comes with the baby to the clinic for whatever, and we make her sing a song. Mothers following this mantra do not lose weight. They have no lactation failure. Lactation failure is usually seen in malnourished mothers. Mothers first lose weight and then they complain of declining output. Eat while you feed and feed while you eat. And that is the way to be happy and lactating. So if they eat whatever they have while lactating, they get extra food and they don't lose weight nor lactation. And this is for the thin babies who are 6 months on. Humpty Dumpty. At 6 months of age, Humpty Dumpty was chubbiest of all. Then his weight had a great fall. And all the world's doctors and milk and tonics could not make Humpty Dumpty chubby again. Then doctor said, start solid home food. Stop milk, stop liquids. Fill pockets with snacks. Close the food gap. And that made Humpty Dumpty chubby again. And song for the boys, Ringa Ringa Roses. House full of snacks, eat all grow well. Adults eat like this and become fat. And for kids, it is eat while you play and play while you eat. And that is the way to be happy and great. Again, not for fat children. Most of us do not know right nutrition. So we eat wrong, we are malnourished. Thin adults and fat adults, anybody's tummy, belly is seen, he's fat and he is malnourished. So let's learn what is right nutrition and give it to our children from 6 months onwards. Dietary guidelines for Indians are written by India's experts. It is for common man. Everyone should know it. It is in 7 languages, 4 South Indian languages, English, Hindi, Urdu, and I have made it in Marathi. Send me an email, I will send you, or NIN can give you. So learn right nutrition for yourself and the kids. 1, kids 6 months onwards. Eat only when hungry. 2, eat half of your need. Three, see the plate. Half the plate should be salads, vegetables, fruits. They give vitamins, minerals, fiber, and no constipation. 1/4 plate, quarter plate should be rice or roti. They give carbohydrates. Quarter plate should be dal, non-veg proteins. A vati of curds, it gives B12. Add a lemon, it gives vitamin C. A spoon of ghee if you like, and not more than a pinch of salt. No salt, no sugar to infants up to 2 years if you can. Globally, they don't give. Then cook in iron kadai, that gives iron. Most children are anemic at happy birthday. It will be avoided if you cook all the food in iron kadais. And if you don't have an iron kadai, you can put two iron nails in the vegetable while cooking it. That gives iron. And if you add lemon to the food, iron absorption is increased. This prevents and treats anemia. And start this at 6 months. This is a key to malnutrition. 1 cup of tea or few biscuits, 3-4 biscuits. Extra per day, add, extra means more than what we need. Add 3 kilos weight a year. If you take this much less, you lose 3 kilo weight a year. Children become malnourished because they are short of food. They get less food. So this is a single key. And no sugar because it causes caries. Sugar sticks to the teeth and it is that point, at that point that we get caries. Then many tiny babies come with fever. So mother is the best thermometer. If she feels the fever on her hand, the skin is hot, but at the baby's mouth is not hot, then it is because of wrapping or because of summer. But if she feels the baby's mouth is warm while feeding and the skin is cold, then not so, as hot as the mouth, then baby has probably illness. So she alone can tell what is the reason for illness. Lastly, mother's milk is a better name than breast milk. Always say mother's milk, not breast milk. Piyush is Amrut. The first day's milk is called as Piyush. It is a better name than colostrum. Our people will understand it. Say Piyush. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hemant. Thank you for finishing on time. Our next speaker is Dr. Prashant Gangal. Dr. Prashant Gangal.
Yes.
Yeah. You can begin now.
Yes. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. Hello, colleagues. I must be thankful to Dr. Hemant and Archana Joshi and Center of Pharma for bringing me over here. You all heard about breastfeeding in detail, about complementary feeding in detail. Now I'll show you the tools by which you can counsel the mother. I have been already introduced, and I would like to introduce you to my organization, BPNI Maharashtra, whose website tells you all about the tools that you need. As soon as you open the website, you can actually do it if your mobile phones are free. The address is BPNI, that is Breastfeeding Promotion Network of India, Maharashtra. So BPNIMaharashtra.org. I'll go slowly so you can open the website. As soon as you open the website, you'll find a pop-up window, which will have all the recent information, what is going on recently. Since World Breastfeeding Week is going on, we have kept some literature of World Breastfeeding Week. There is a PowerPoint made by Vaba, which are there, so you can access it. As you go down the website on the home page, I'll go a little down. Okay. Now, there are 3 services provided by us. One is breastfeeding help, especially Mumbai, Maharashtra, and few other towns of India, and trainings which we offer and hospitals visited. Now, let's go to the breastfeeding help page. Breastfeeding in last 20 years has become a science by itself. Doctors and nurses may not have enough time to help the mothers, but now we are lactation counselors and lactation consultants. In Mumbai, we have them predominantly trained by BPNI Maharashtra. We cover 85 maternity homes and our counselors also go for home visits. You can take their help. I'll just show you how easy we have made it. So I'll just click on breastfeeding help. I hope my net works fast so I can show you because I have to go to the quiz. Finishing this in 5 minutes. Okay. Here comes a map of India. And what we do is exactly given over here. Feeding on advice on complementary feeding is also available. The dots show the places where the help is available. And if you don't want to do the map, you have the names of the cities. Like for example, if I click in Mumbai, I'll immediately get, sorry, I clicked on Alibaba, I'll click on Mumbai, so I have more people to show you. Mumbai. Down below, a table opens up. And if you want to find out, I'm staying in Malad, so I want to find out who is available in Malad. And if I type Malad and enter it, I immediately get a list of people who are trained as lactation counselors and consultants. I go back to the home page. You can directly call from here or you can directly email from here so that the help is available. Okay. I go down again. We also offer a lot of trainings. These trainings range from 2 to 3 hours, as we what you call as sensitization, up to 3 days. And we have a conglomerate of four workshops. It's a 12 days of training, which we use to train our delegates to appear for an international exam called IBCLC. That is International Board Certified Lactation Consultant. So there are a variety of trainings kept over here. I won't open this particular page because it consumes time. And the third is hospitals visited. Many hospitals where counselors go, their practices are up to the mark. And we have tried to make them baby friendly. BFHI or baby friendly hospital is a concept introduced by WHO and UNICEF, which says that if 10 successful steps of breastfeeding are followed, then a hospital can be given a certificate by authorities, which is called baby friendly hospital certificate. We have more than 65 international board certified lactation consultants and about 100 people who are extremely qualified. And in the next 6 months, we plan to train them as commandos of BFHI. And at least in Maharashtra, we will be able to provide this service of assessing and training the hospital. I won't call it assessment, helping the maternity homes to become baby friendly. So you can take advantage of this. We have developed a mother support group. What is a mother support group? Mother support group is mothers, experienced mothers, who have been trained to help new mothers. This is a concept which is well known in America and in advanced countries and European countries, where after discharge, the mothers follow up with the mother support group for lactation help. All Europe, American, Australia, New Zealand hospitals, maternity homes have got lactation consultants. Some hospitals may have it full-time, some hospitals may have it round the clock even at night. So we also need to bring this concept, just like orthopedic hospitals have got physiotherapists and occupational therapists to help the change the situation. We need to have colleges, medical colleges, just like OTPT courses, courses for lactation counselors and consultants. I go down. Before I start with the BPNI program highlights, what we are not shown over here is training of traditional massage women. In 2001, we conducted training of 500 traditional massage women, Malishwali Mausi or by what we call, and on two grounds, teaching her about infant feeding practices, about breastfeeding and complementary feeding, so that she can talk to the mother and teach her about these particular aspects. We also trained her not to do certain things which they were doing and which are harmful for the baby. Dr. Hemant Joshi showed you breast abscess. So we taught her not to express the milk. We also taught her that nobody should be cleaning baby's mouth because that introduces infection. And not to massage very heavily where we can cause fractures. So the training is available. This type, the information on this particular project is available in past activities. You can go and access that what exactly we did. Now these five highlights which are shown here, this is breast crawl, the first one, which I made green by pointing an arrow. Now breast crawl is a concept just like a calf would go to the udder of the cow as soon as it is born. Nobody tells the calf to go to the and have the milk. But calf does it. Can a human baby do it if it is more intelligent than the calf? Certainly. Only problem is it cannot jump up to the mother's chest in between the two breasts. So soon after delivery, either with the cord cut or without the cord cut, of course, we must ensure that the baby has cried. If the baby is kept in between two breasts, baby finds a nipple by itself. This has been recorded by Karolinska Institute from Sweden. We rejuvenated it in the site breastcrawl.org. You can show this to pregnant mothers, that how baby can self-latch after delivery. And it's a great experience for the mothers. Baby just kept in between the breasts and at the eyes at the level of nipple, and the baby will find the breast by itself. I won't go into details. Please visit breastcrawl.org and you will find the breastcrawl video kept free of cost over there. There is a dossier kept over there and you can give it to every pregnant mother and families to show them how to initiate breastfeeding by animal way. And that's the best way to initiate feeding because that is most natural. It also initiates the development of the brain. Second was Hirkani Kaksha, which Dr. Hemant Joshi referred to. Hirkani was a milkmaid at the time of Shivaji. She was got caught up on Raigad for some reason beyond sunset, and she had to go down to feed her baby. Of course, the doors of Raigad had got closed down. So she climbed down the cliff to reach to her baby. And Shivaji was very happy at her bravery, and he has named that particular cliff as Hirkani Buruj. She was a working mom. Present day moms also face a lot of difficulties and in breastfeeding, in terms of going for the job or in terms of different problems. So they are also like Hirkanis. So Hirkani Kaksha is meant for working mothers or in public places where mothers can feed. Maharashtra government has picked up this concept, and there are more than 1,000 Hirkani rooms in Maharashtra now. So you must try to promote Hirkani Kaksha at workplaces, at public places, and in your clinics. Your clinics are big, hospitals are there where you can open the Hirkani Kaksha. A lot of mothers come over there. Then we introduce the concept of 4D clinic or four-dimensional immunization clinic. What does it mean? 4Ds mean, first D is diet and growth monitoring. We have devised a diet audit sheet, which you can use at every immunization to see what exactly mother is doing about food. And at 6 months end, you can use it to teach mother how to give complementary feeding. Then you also plot the babies on WHO growth standards, on weight, height, and weight for height. And if you correlate the diet audit and the weight, nobody is presently correlating diet and growth. If the growth chart goes down, that means something is going wrong. Growth chart leaves the line and goes up, that means something is going wrong. And growth charts speak. In Marathi, I call them bolke growth charts. Bolne wale growth charts. Jaise bolne wali gudiya rehti hai waise. वो आपको बताएंगे कि कुछ गलत हो रहा है, क्या गलत हो रहा है, ये भी शायद बताएंगे. तो आप प्लीज फॉलो कीजिए WHO ग्रोथ चार्ट. सेकंड इज डेवलपमेंट. चार्टिंग डेवलपमेंट इज एक्सट्रीमली इंपॉर्टेंट. इफ द चाइल्ड इज लैगिंग, ही मे नीड सम हेल्प, ही मे नीड इन्वेस्टिगेशन, ही मे नीड फिजियोथेरेपी. यू कैन पिक अप ऑटिस्टिक किड जस्ट बाय डिलेड लैंग्वेज इन सम केसेस. थर्ड इज ड्रग्स. मदर्स नीड कैल्शियम, लैक्टेटिंग मदर्स नीड कैल्शियम एंड आयरन. हु विल टॉक अबाउट लैक्टेटिंग अबाउट दिस? Of course, pediatricians have family doctors when child comes for immunization. Mother has to be told about contraceptive advice at 1.5 months because she may become pregnant again even before going to next pregnancy. And last is dose. So if we pick our hand as medical practitioners to give vaccine or dose before discussing first 3Ds, I think it is criminal, because vaccination is the immunization only chance where we can speak about these things. It's the concept of Navjat Shishu Agaman Kaksha or Navjat Shishu Reception. Swagata Kaksha for the newborn. A new citizen of this country is coming in. So we must start and help the mothers in such a way that her oxytocin goes up in the delivery room itself, and we are not required to add oxytocin to the bottle or the IV fluids. So that's Navjat Shishu Agaman Kaksha concept, not just by physical sense. It should be the best decorated room in the country, because we are welcoming the citizen of this country which is coming over here. The behavior of the staff also should be like, the, you know, 100 years back, the delivery used to occur at home, where mausi rehti thi, kaki rehti thi, mummy rehti thi, dadi nani bhi ho sakte the. Jitne pyar se wo log bartao karenge maa ke saath, utni pyar ke saath arogya karmacharya ne bartao karna chahiye. Aur yahi concept hai Navjat Shishu Agaman Kaksha ka. And last is Shishu Poshan app, which is over here. With the help of TCS and KM Hospital, we are given technical content. And this app in 3 languages, Dr. Hemant Joshi would be happy to know that. It is in Hindi, Marathi and English. So we can give this all to app to all pregnant and lactating mothers. And our entire first level 3 module is almost kept over there. Different sections, frequently asked questions, and you will find everything that is necessary for a mother, including the quiz, which I'll be going now. You go down the website and we find our activities. You can go over here and have a look. There are 20 resources for mothers. There are frequently asked questions. There are expressing breast milk, how to do it. We are going to keep a lot of videos over here. Again, our level 1 module, 3 days module, a lot of videos will be kept over here in next month or so. So you can access those videos. Right now, we have kept breast crawl video. We have kept a COVID video over there. So you can go to this section and find it. Now we are going to go to quiz. You can open this quiz on your mobile and solve along with me. And I will talk about each question as the question comes up. Okay. Are you also opening the quiz on your mobile phone? Okay. So here is the breastfeeding quiz. Now, we have started antenatal sessions for pregnant mothers, not just for mothers, but for fathers also, for nanas and dadas, because all family members have to be trained about breastfeeding and complementary feeding. It is everyone's responsibility. So you can give this quiz to them in whatever language you want. It's available in 3 languages on the app also. And once they answer the questions, you know that where exactly the problem is, where their knowledge is lacking. So correct them on those particular points. At the end of the quiz, they also get marks. And all the answers are given at the end of the quiz. So if all parents before delivery solve this particular quiz, then they will be able to know where they are going wrong. So first question I'll answer for you, glucose, water, sugar, jaggery, plain water, honey should be given to a baby before first breastfeed. What is the answer? Quite a few families will try to try ovum or some other later on baby's tongue. Especially Dadi does it and says that child should talk sweet like honey all his life. It's not correct, because this will fill up baby's stomach and also introduce infections. So these items can be extremely dangerous. So I would say no. And we must ask the family, what are your plans to give to the baby as soon as the baby is born? What are you planning to give? It's a koi. So you can ask them, are you planning to give jaggery? Are you planning to give sugar? Or are you planning to give honey? And they will very innocently tell you what exactly they are going to do. Our very smart one might say, no, we are not going to do anything. But when you quietly open their drawers, you will find a bottle of honey kept over there. So be aware of these practices. Second question, after a normal delivery, breastfeeding should be initiated within. I think you heard about it. It should be initiated in 1 hour. But what many people will do, they will try to put the baby at breast at 59 minutes and 59 seconds, just like the cost of Bata shoes. And we'll say, merrily, that we are initiating breastfeeding within 1 hour. That's not true. Skin-to-skin contact has to be initiated in about 5 minutes. That is also anavrutto. That means skin-to-skin contact has to be initiated, like breast crawl, and allow the baby to be there so that baby finds the breast by itself by 1 hour. Sometimes the help may be required in for terms of, you know, holding the breast on the side and helping the mother to baby to get the nipple. But most of the times, as you will see in the breast crawl video, the child has reached the nipples and started suckling in 12 minutes. So the skin-to-skin contact starts at 5 minutes, and the skin-to-skin contact continues till the first breastfeed get over. So this is the other two things which we have to remember, and not just putting the baby to breast at 59 minutes and 59 seconds. There are a lot of advantages. You can read in the breast crawl or dossier. Number three, a mother is not able to sit up for 24 to 80 or 48 hours after a cesarean delivery. However, she should breastfeed her baby. True or false? Many people and many hospitals don't start breastfeeding for almost 48 hours. Operation kahan pe hua hai? Operation to pet ke upar hua hai, chhati ke upar nahi hua hai. Maa soye rehti hai ya baithe rehti hai. Bachcha to aada hi rehta hai. To kya problem hai? Relatives ko sikhana chahiye ki cesarean delivery ho to koi madad lagegi. Aur aise vyakti ko bhejiye ki jo raat bhar jagega aur maa ko madad karega. So yes, it has to be initiated in the same way. Yes, even if the baby gets transferred to a premature unit, pehle 3 din to doodh kam aata hai, katori mein nikal nahi sakte, to kya karne ka? To jitne bhi droplets expression karke nipple ke upar aa jate hai, wo 2 ml syringe se aap pick up kar sakte hai. Aur wo usse aap ko sunke hairan honge aap, ki delivery ke baad bhi hum log ne OT table ke upar twins ko transfer kiya tha, dono baju se 5-5 ml colostrum nikla. Ye to liquid gold hai. अपने एंटीबायोटिक से भी बहुत पावरफुल है, तो ये क्यों ना दे? तो सिजेरियन डिलीवरी हो या कोई भी हो, माँ फीडिंग कर सकती है. बच्चों का पहला फीड भगवान तैयार रखता है क्रियोला में, तो इसलिए इसका आंसर यस आएगा. फोर, ब्रेस्ट मिल्क इन द फर्स्ट 2 to 3 days आफ्टर डिलीवरी इज इनएडिक्वेट इन क्वांटिटी, हेंस ड्यूरिंग दिस पीरियड इट इज नेसेसरी टू फीड आउटसाइड मिल्क. मोस्ट ऑफ द प्राइवेट मैटरनिटी होम्स, आई शुड से दिस, दैट गवर्नमेंट हॉस्पिटल्स आर मच बेटर, ऑल सिजेरियन बेबीज आर गिवन आउटसाइड मिल्क, व्हिच इज नॉट करेक्ट. More than 50% of normal babies are given outside milk. Again, this is not correct. Yes, the colostrum is less. Why colostrum is less? Because baby's stomach capacity is less. मैं हमेशा दिखाता हूँ, मेरा इतना अंगूठे जितना baby का पेट पहले दिन पे रहता है, तो उतना ही दूध की जरूरत है बच्चे को. बार बार पिलाते रहिए. जब भी गंगा की शुरुआत होती है, गंगा इतनी बड़ी नदी है, गंगोत्री पे जाके देखो तो इसकी धारा कितनी है, कितनी छोटी है. हरिद्वार ऋषिकेश पहुंच जाओ, कितनी बड़ी हो जाती है धारा. बार बार पिला पीने से दूध बढ़ जाता है, और जितना आता है पहले 3 दिन उतना काफी रहता है. लेकिन बार बार बच्चे को सकलिंग के लिए अवसर देना, ये बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है. रोने तक रुकिए मत. बच्चा मुंह खोल के मांगने को शुरुआत करेगा, चुप चुप आवाज निकालेगा मुंह से, आंख खोल के मम्मी को ढूंढने को शुरुआत करेगा, प्लीज छाती पे लगाइए. और बांध के मत रखिए बच्चे को. आप बांध के रखेंगे तो बच्चे को लगता है कि मैं पेट में हूँ, वो सोया हुआ रहता है. तो क्या करना चाहिए? तो बच्चे को एक एक दो दो घंटे से ओपन करके कपड़े निकाल के माँ का स्किन टू स्किन कॉन्टैक्ट जैसे ब्रेस्ट क्रॉल में देते हैं वैसे देना चाहिए. उससे क्या होगा? बच्चा जाग जाएगा और फीडिंग के लिए प्रवृत्त हो जाएगा. सो इवन इफ इट इज इनएडिक्वेट, यू माइट फील इट इज इनएडिक्वेट, बट इट इज एडिक्वेट फॉर द बेबी. सो नो आउटसाइड मिल्क. सो विल आंसर नो. ओके, वेयर शुड द बेबी बी केप्ट इन द मैटरनिटी होम? क्रेडल में भी रखने की जरूरत नहीं, माँ के बिल्कुल बाजू में, ताकि माँ का और बच्चे का स्पर्श होता रहे और माँ देखते पाए कि बच्चे जैसे ही मुंह खोला छाती मुंह में, जैसे ही मुंह खोला छाती मुंह में, तो बच्चे को रोने के लिए अवसर ही नहीं देना चाहिए। तो कोई बच्चा रोएगा नहीं, और कोई बच्चा रोएगा नहीं तो बाहर का दूध देने की जरूरत भी नहीं पड़ेगी। सो विद द मदर इन द सेम और एट बेड और अटैच बेड, कोई भी माँ बच्चे को सो नहीं सकती है अनलेस वो शी इज टेकिंग टैबलेट्स फॉर सम स्लीप और शी इज ऑन सम ड्रग्स और शी इज हैज गॉट कन्वर्जन। सो मे बी प्राइमरी है, वी कैन कीप अ वॉच, द लेडीज कैन कीप अ वॉच फॉर 15 डेज, उसके बाद माँ भी बहुत होशियार हो जाती है और माँ के मन में एक सबकॉन्शियस ब्रेन काम कर रहता है, वो उसको प्रिवेंट करेगा। सो इट शुड बी द मदर। Once the breastfeeding is established after 15 days, baby should be breastfed every, so 15 दिन के अंदर बार बार पिलाना है, 10 बार, 15 बार, 20 बार, 25 बार, जितनी भी बार हो सकते हैं, minimum 10 times. Once the breastfeeding gets established, the baby starts putting on weight, the baby starts passing enough urine, as Dr. Anjali Gopan told you, at 6 to 7 times पिशाब कर रहा है, diaper गीला हो रहा है, diaper में recommend नहीं करता हूँ, और बच्चे का वजन बढ़ रहा है, तो यहाँ पे थोड़ा बच्चे को हम छोड़ सकते हैं, फिर भी कम से कम 8 बार होना चाहिए। So after 15 days demand, but before 15 days no demand feeding. What is the duration of normal breastfeeding? Some babies are fast feeders, some babies are slow feeders. So इसलिए duration of normal breastfeeding I have put as 10 to 45 minutes. कोई बच्चा 10 मिनट में भी खत्म करेगा, कुछ बच्चे 5-10 मिनट में भी खत्म करेंगे, कुछ बच्चे को 45 minutes लग सकते हैं. But by and large not more than 45 minutes. If the feeds are getting extended beyond 45 minutes, you should suspect that there is some breastfeeding problem. Which option should be chosen by HIV positive mothers? In India for feeding her baby. पहले बात अलग थी, वो 4-5 क्राइटेरिया हम लोग यूज करते हैं, अभी ऐसा नहीं है। सभी माओं को HIV पॉजिटिव हो या नहीं हो, हम एक्सक्लूसिव ब्रेस्टफीडिंग का ऑप्शन ही बताते हैं। तो ये बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है कि हम HIV पॉजिटिव हो या निगेटिव हो, सभी को एक्सक्लूसिव ब्रेस्टफीडिंग की सलाह दें। ऑफकोर्स में जो प्रिकॉशन लेना है वो डिटेल डिस्कशन में हो जाएगा। हाउ मच पार्ट ऑफ द ब्रेस्ट शुड बी इन बेबीज माउथ व्हाइल ब्रेस्टफीडिंग? ओनली निपल, निपल एंड स्मार्ट पार्ट ऑफ एरियोला, निपल एंड मैक्सिमम एरियोला, एनी पार्ट। हम टूथपेस्ट सुबह जब ब्रशिंग के लिए लेते हैं, हम आगे नहीं दबाते, पीछे दबाते, वैसे दूध काले भाग में रहता है, और इसके लिए द आंसर यहाँ आएगा निपल एंड मैक्सिमम पार्ट ऑफ एरियोला। बच्चा सिर्फ निपल लेगा तो क्या होगा, मम्मी को क्रैक्स आ जाएंगे, जख्म हो जाएगी। इफ अ बेबी क्राइज एक्सेसिवली, इट मीन्स दैट अ मदर्स मिल्क इज इनएडिक्वेट। माँ घर जाती है, घर में तो हॉस्पिटल में तो सिस्टर केयर लेती है, घर पे जाने के बाद सब लोग खुश रहते हैं 9 दिन, लेकिन मराठी में कहावत है नवची नवलाई 9 दिवस। उसके बाद बच्चों लोगों को बच्चे के रोने का तंगी आ जाती है, तो क्या करते हैं, बच्चा रोता है तुम्हारा दूध कम पड़ा। ऐसे नहीं है, बच्चे को रोने को चांस नहीं दे जाए, ये तो एक पहला है। और हर एक टाइम बच्चा रोता है इसका मतलब ये नहीं कि उसको दूध कम पड़ रहा है, बच्चा कई कारणों से रो सकता है। ये भी इसलिए रो सकता है, उसको गर्मी लगती हो, ठंडक लगती हो, तो हर एक टाइम ये नहीं होता है कि बच्चा रोता है इसका मतलब उसको दूध पूरा पड़ रहा है। क्या ढूंढना चाहिए हमें, क्या बेबी क्राई इट मीन्स दैट मदर इनएडिक्वेट? नो, there may be many other reasons for crying. An exclusively breastfed baby may pass stools very frequently or once in 7 days. चौथे पांचवें दिन तक बच्चा बार बार स्टूल पास करता है, और वो भी येलो कलर का। शुरुआत में स्टूल काले कलर का रहता है, सेकंड डे ग्रीन, थर्ड डे येलोइश ग्रीन, और चौथे पांचवें दिन से येलो हल्दी ऐसा, और बार बार स्टूल पास करने को शुरुआत करता है। ये नॉर्मल है, लोग डर जाते हैं, मैं बोलता हूँ अच्छा है पेड़े बांटो, ट्रैफिक चालू हो गया। और इसलिए पहले महीना भर में बच्चे ज्यादा संडास करेंगे, लेकिन घर जाने के बाद 1-1.5 महीने के बाद बच्चा 1 दिन में 1 बार, 2 दिन में 1 बार, 3 दिन में 1 बार, 4 दिन में 1 बार कर सकता है। सो बार बार भी कर सकता है शुरुआत के महीने, 1 महीने में, और बाद में ये फ्रीक्वेंसी कम हो सकती है, दोनों नॉर्मल है। यस दिस इज ट्रू, यस बेबी मे पास स्टूल्स समटाइम्स वेरी फ्रीक्वेंटली, समटाइम्स वंस इन 7 to 8 डेज। हाउ टू रिकॉग्नाइज दैट मदर्स मिल्क इज सफिशिएंट फॉर द बेबी आफ्टर 15 डेज? पहले 15 दिन की बात अभी नहीं करता हूँ क्योंकि बहुत टाइम जाएगा, लेकिन स्टूल और वजन से पहले 15 दिन में वजन कम हो जाता है, लेकिन जैसे पहले स्पीचेस में बताया गया कि 14 दिन तक बच्चे का वजन बर्थ वेट के आगे जाना चाहिए, और 7वें दिन का वजन 3रे दिन के वजन से ज्यादा चाहिए। लेकिन 15 दिन के बाद आपने देख लिया कि यूरिन आउटपुट और वेट से हम लोग जान सकते हैं कि बच्चे का वजन, बच्चे को दूध मिल रहा है कि नहीं मिल रहा है। आई एम रशिंग थ्रू बिकॉज माई टाइम इज गेटिंग ओवर। अ मदर हैज सफिशियंट ब्रेस्ट मिल्क, शी वॉन्ट्स टू गिव अवर चाइल्ड 1 to 2 कप्स ऑफ एनिमल मिल्क। घर में गाय भैंस है तो बोलती है मैं 2 टाइम दे दूं, दूध अलग से देने की जरूरत नहीं है। 6 महीने के बाद भी मिक्स करने के लिए, जैसे डॉक्टर हेमंत जोशी ने बोला, माँ का दूध इस्तेमाल कर सकते हैं, खीर बनाने के लिए बाहर का दूध इस्तेमाल करें तो ठीक है, लेकिन 2 साल पूरा होने के बाद जब भी ब्रेस्टफीडिंग का पोषण का महत्व लिमिटेड हो जाता है और बच्चा पसंद करता है तो ही बाहर का दूध दे सकते हैं। 6-8 महीने के बाद बाहर का दूध अलग लेके बैठने की जरूरत नहीं है। तो आफ्टर 2 ईयर्स ऑफ एज, बट दैट ऑल्सो इज द चाइल्ड वॉन्ट्स। वेन एक्सक्लूसिवली ब्रेस्ट breastfeeding mother should start giving food along with breast milk. ये तो आपने सुन लिया, पहले जैसी कॉन्ट्रोवर्सी नहीं है, चार महीना, चार से छह महीना, छह महीने के बाद, और वो भी छह महीना पूरा होने के बाद, छठवां महीना बैठेगा तभी नहीं. What kind of hygienically prepared fresh homemade food should be given to the baby? Juice, rice, dal, water, soup. ये बहुत लोगों को बहुत पसंद आता है ये देने के लिए, लेकिन वो देने की जरूरत नहीं है. बच्चा पतला हो जाएगा, डॉक्टर हेमंत जोशी जैसा बोलते हैं कि छह महीने का बालकृष्ण पतला हो जाएगा. तो मैच फैमिली फूड अपने साथ खिलाइए और अलग कुछ बनाइए नहीं. आई एम यूजिंग हिंदी बिकॉज दैट इज द वे वी टॉक टू द पेरेंट्स क्वाइट अ फ्यू टाइम्स. व्हाट शुड बी द टोटल ड्यूरेशन ऑफ ब्रेस्ट फीडिंग? 1 year, 2 years? द आंसर इज 2 years एंड बियॉन्ड. 2 साल तक. ये भी एक मिसकंसेप्शन है कि 6 महीने के बाद फूड बढ़ाओ और माँ का दूध कम करो. सच नहीं है. 6 महीने के बाद भी आपको ध्यान में रखना है कि जितना माँ 6 महीने का दूध पिलाए उतना ही सेकंड बर्थडे तक पिलाना चाहिए, तो ही बच्चे का वजन अप रहेगा. 40% प्रोटीन्स एंड 30% कैलोरीज बिटवीन 6 मंथ्स एंड 2 ईयर्स कम्स फ्रॉम मदर्स मिल्क. और 2 और 5 साल के बीच में टॉनिक जैसा पिलाना चाहिए. 5 साल में बच्चे की जो प्रतिकार शक्ति एडल्ट जैसी हो जाती है ऑलमोस्ट, तो बीमारियों का प्रमाण कम हो जाता है. उसके बाद माँ दूध बंद कर सकती है. तो इट इज नथिंग रॉन्ग कि मदर फीड्स फ्यू टाइम्स आफ्टर 2 ईयर्स ऑफ एज ऑल्सो. बेबी शुड बी हैबिचुएटेड टू ड्रिंक वाटर एंड मिल्क फ्रॉम बॉटल. ऐसे पेरेंट्स को लगता है, वो कभी सीपर भी दे देते हैं. तो ऐसा करना चाहिए? नहीं करना चाहिए. ऐसे कुछ हैबिचुएट करने की जरूरत नहीं रहती है. हम लोग जैसे कटोरी से पीते हैं, प्याले से पानी पीते हैं, वैसे बच्चा कटोरी से पी लेगा. फीडिंग बेबी बालकड़ू ग्राइप वाटर टॉनिक्स फॉर टीथिंग सोमवार चौथरीसी कुमारी आसो, इज इट नेसेसरी और नॉट? जरूरत नहीं है. हाथी घोड़ा जिराफ अपने बच्चों को ये कुछ पिलाते नहीं है, फिर भी शेर का शेर ही होता है. ये सब चीजें अननेसेसरी तो है ही, लेकिन साथ में डेंजरस भी हो सकती है. तो कृपया इन चीजों का इस्तेमाल नहीं कीजिए. अ लैक्टेटिंग मदर शुड अवॉइड ईटिंग सर्टन फूड्स. ऐसे लोग मानते हैं, लेकिन ऐसे करने की जरूरत नहीं है. माँ को तो मैं विशलिस्ट देने के लिए बोलता हूँ कि पहले 7 दिन आपको ब्रेकफास्ट लंच डिनर में जो भी चाहिए लिख लीजिए, वो मिल जाएगा आपको. तो प्लीज, जैसे डॉक्टर हेमंत जोशी ने बोला, पिलाते पिलाते खाना चाहिए. माँ ने खाते खाते पिलाना चाहिए. घर में मेहमान आते हैं तो पानी का ग्लास देते हैं. तो अगर माँ पिलाने के लिए बैठी है तो उसके सामने एक पानी का ग्लास रखना चाहिए और कटोरी में कुछ अच्छा खाना रखना चाहिए. चना हो, सिंग हो, दूध की कटोरी हो, दही की कटोरी हो, तो माँ को अच्छा दूध आएगा, वो भी खुश रहेगी. एक्स्ट्रा लड्डू खाने की जरूरत नहीं है, लेकिन ये चीजों से बहुत मदद मिलेगी. तो कोई रिस्ट्रिक्ट करने की जरूरत नहीं. माँ जो चाहिए वो खा सकती है. तो यस, शुड अवॉइड सर्टन आइटम्स? नो, शी शुड नॉट अवॉइड. आफ्टर डिलीवरी व्हेन शुड मदर स्टार्ट, इज द लास्ट क्वेश्चन, मदर शुड स्टार्ट यूजिंग फैमिली प्लानिंग ऑप्शंस. काफी टाइम माओं को लगता है कि पीरियड आ जाएगा फिर मुझे अगले प्रेगनेंसी में मैं जाने वाली है. ऐसा नहीं है. पीरियड आने के पहले भी माँ नेक्स्ट प्रेगनेंसी, शी कैन गो इनटू नेक्स्ट प्रेगनेंसी. सो ऑल मदर्स शुड बी काउंसल्ड अलॉन्ग विद फर्स्ट पोलियो ट्रिपल टू टेक कॉन्ट्रासेप्टिव एडवाइस. दैट मीन्स एक्चुअली टू इम्प्लीमेंट इट फॉर अ मदर हु हैज डिलीवर्ड द कॉपर टी और इंट्राउटराइन कॉन्ट्रासेप्टिव डिवाइस इज द बेस्ट ऑप्शन. ओनली 10-15% ऑफ मदर्स मे नॉट बी एबल टू टॉलरेट इट. वो 1.5 मंथ्स आफ्टर डिलीवरी. इसमें और एक ऑप्शन है जो थोड़ा सच भी है कि सून आफ्टर डिलीवरी. अभी नए IUCDs आए हैं जो डिलीवरी के बाद तुरंत बिठाए जा सकते हैं. यस, दैट ऑप्शन मे बी करेक्ट, बट वी हैव केप्ट ओवर हियर बिकॉज़ इट्स स्टैंडर्ड. सो ऑल पीडियाट्रिशियंस अंडर 3D व्हिच आई मेंशनड इन 4D क्लिनिक अलोंग विद फर्स्ट पोलियो ट्रिपल शुड काउंसिल द मदर्स. यहाँ मैं सबमिट नहीं कर रहा हूँ, मुझे मालूम है मेरा स्कोर 20/20 है. यहाँ पे आंसर्स भी हम लोग ने दिए हुए हैं कि गलत आंसर भी दिए, सही है तो सही क्यों दिया ये भी दिया हुआ है. और इसके साथ मदर को FAQ पढ़ने को बोलेंगे तो ऑटोमेटिकली उसका नॉलेज आ पाएगा और जो भी प्रैक्टिसेस चेंज हो जाएगी. अभी एक दो एडिशंस डॉक्टर अंजलि कोकर ने बहुत अच्छा बताया कोविड टाइम में क्या करेंगे. एक इसमें मुझे 99% ऑफ द मदर्स आर नॉट गोइंग टू बी कोविड पॉजिटिव. 99% ऑफ द मदर्स आर नॉट गोइंग टू हैव एनी सिम्टम ऑफ कॉफ एंड कोल्ड. तो नॉर्मल मदर है जिसको कोई भी सिम्टम नहीं, कुछ भी प्रॉब्लम नहीं है कोविड के, तो शुड शी वेयर अ मास्क और मिनिमल द सास इट, नॉट नेसेसरी. वेयर इन योर हाउस इन द बेबी इफ यू आर नो कॉफ कोल्ड, नो साइंस ऑफ कोरोना या कोरोना निगेटिव, you are not corona positive, please don't wear mask when you are breastfeeding the baby or caring for the baby. Kiss your baby in plenty, hold your baby, give plenty of skin to skin contact. Only if you are cough cold, you are COVID positive, then you should be wearing the mask. Of course, hygienic precautions are necessary for everybody. Thank you very much. Sorry, I took 5 minutes extra. Thank you very much. I have finished.
We invite our speaker, Dr. Jayashree Monkar. Dr. Jayashree. Dr. Jayashree, stop sharing screen.
Yes, stop.
It's going to tell us about the breast milk banking.
A very good evening to you all. And I must say that it's been a wonderful session so far. So many wonderful speakers giving so much of information. It's really a pleasure to be part of this webinar. And I'd like to thank Dr. Archana and Dr. Hemant, as well as Centaur Pharma, for giving me this opportunity to participate in this webinar and talk on my experiences on mother's milk and the role of human milk banking to save newborn lives. I'm going to start with a small story. This is a success story of our unit. This is Priyanka. And Priyanka is, you can see her with her family, with her lovely chubby baby weighing 2.9 kilos. She's going home. She went home on the 23rd of July, but she went home after a period of 3.5 months. And the reason for her going home so late was that when she was about 6.5 months pregnant, she developed eclampsia and therefore resulted in a preterm delivery and a very extremely preterm baby born at 26 weeks of gestation with a weight of 620 grams. Priyanka could finally come to the unit to see her baby and to express out her milk for her baby only by about day 8 because of her eclampsia and of her severe edema. Added to this, when the baby was 2.5 months old, still in the neonatal intensive care unit, during her hospital stay with her baby, she developed COVID. And she again had fever, for a high fever for almost 5 to 6 days. She used to intermittently express and send her milk to the NICU, but she couldn't do it as frequently as she was doing before. So what was the, you know, mantra of her success? So the mantra of her success, and you know that her 620 gramma at 3.5 months of life finally went home as a 2.9 kilo happy baby, was because first a burning desire to breastfeed. It was really wonderful to see. Even through her COVID, she would send them, you know, express the milk in the, from the wards, send it in a container, and her husband used to bring it to the unit. The second important thing is timely availability of banked, pasteurized donor human milk when she was not in a position to feed her baby. And third, of course, was her being able to give kangaroo mother care to her baby. And that was the secret of her success. So you'd be surprised to know that almost 3.6 million, that is 36 lakh babies are born preterm in our own country every year. Fortunately, most of these babies, about 80% of them, are born between 30 to 37 weeks. So what we call the moderate or the late preterm babies. But still, despite being not so very, very preterm that they require aggressive intensive care, many of them still die because of lack of essential care. And it's finally breastfeeding, that, you know, triangulated approach, breastfeeding, use of pasteurized donor human milk where mother's milk is not available, and kangaroo mother care, which makes the difference between survival and death for these babies. Mother's milk is important for all babies, but it is particularly more important for babies who are born preterm. And when babies are very preterm, the very low birth weight, as we call them, less than 1500 grams, then having access to human milk actually helps reduce the stay in NICU. And how does it do that? One is the babies are, it reduces the incidence of feeding tolerance, of feeding intolerance. So babies, will tolerate milk feed better. They will tolerate human milk better. It will reduce the incidence of sepsis, necrotizing enterocolitis. Babies will have less complications like retinopathy of prematurity. And of course, very important, the long-term neurodevelopmental outcomes of babies who receive human milk are always better. Now, it's very often babies of these, mothers of these sick babies, you know, who do not have sometimes access to their own mother's milk. Basically, for the reason that, you know, either because the reason why they're born preterm, the mother has a problem and therefore, or secondly, just the shock of having a baby in the neonatal intensive care unit again makes it, difficult for babies to, for mothers to be able to produce enough milk. And such times when mother's own milk is not available, then what is the next best alternative? Rather than using another species milk, it is better to use another mother's milk. And this is where the human milk bank comes into play. Because the human milk bank is a service which ensures that the milk is collected from the willing donor mothers, it is processed, it is made safe in each and every way before it is handed, before it is given to babies in the neonatal intensive care unit to save their lives. So as you know, the first human milk bank in Asia was set up at our in my institution, the Lokmanya Tilak Municipal Medical College and General Hospital, popularly known as Sion Hospital. it was established way back in 1989, so we have 30 years into service with using the human milk bank. And this human milk bank every year virtually saves the lives of about 3,000 to 5,000 newborn babies who require this human milk. So this is the human milk bank as it stood over the years, and over the years it has gone repetitive upgradation of its services. And this is the current status of the human milk bank. In the year 2019, we have been recognized by the central government, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, as what is called a zonal reference center. So we are here to help more institutions in the country set up milk banks. Currently, almost till 2010 to 12, there were hardly any milk banks in the country, hardly four or five. It's only in the past 5 to 7 years that the number of milk banks has increased, but 70 milk banks is still a very small number to be able to look after 3.5 million plus babies who might require the help of a human milk bank for some time. Now, currently also there is additional help by the government, because they came out with the national guidelines in the year 2017. And what is very interesting is, and I was part of the guideline writing group, what is very interesting is that it's not called a human milk bank. What we call it is a comprehensive lactation management center. And this really has been coordinated. So it really tells you the focus is still breastfeeding, and a human milk bank is ancillary support to breastfeeding practices so that a mother can go home successfully breastfeeding her baby. In the next about 10 minutes, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you through a conducted tour of all the processes that are involved in human milk banking. So if you talk about human bank, the first thing that you require is to have donor mothers. So now the donor mothers, unlike in the West, where once donor mother agrees to donate, she expresses at home and she sends this milk to the human milk bank staff coming through. She freezes it in her freezer or in the freezer compartment of her refrigerator. And then this milk is then picked up by the milk bank staff. In India, most of the donor population is what is a cross-sectional population. So we recruit our mothers from the postnatal care wards, day two, day three, as the milk production is more than the requirements of the baby. Or mothers have congested breasts. And the lactation counselors help them to successfully breastfeed their babies. And if they success milk, they encourage them to express it and to donate this milk to the milk bank. Another group of mothers are the mothers whose babies are in NICU. Now, very often the first few days, just like Priyanka, they're not, the babies are sick, they're not in a position to take too much of milk. All that we start is what we call minimal enteral nutrition, which may be 1 or 2 cc's every 3 hourly. So then, but if the mothers have to initiate lactation and have to maintain lactation, then what is very, very important is that they have to keep on expressing out their milk. So we encourage these mothers to express their milk from both the breasts every 2 to 3 hourly, at least 8 to 10 times in 24 hours. And rather than throwing away this milk, what is important is that this milk is then used, they're motivated to give it to the human milk bank. Then another major group is mothers who follow up in the well baby clinic. We run a daily well baby clinic, and we also have a lactation management clinic along with it. So that is to help mothers with breastfeeding problems and also to motivate them to donate milk. I'm also very happy to say that, now the awareness of milk banking is going on increasing. And today we have donor mothers, the educated mothers who come forward and tell us that we want to donate our milk. And last year, in the year 2019, we had 60 such donor mothers who expressed milk at home, put it into their freezers, and then our milk bank man went and collected the milk from the various donor mothers. And these mothers donated anywhere from 1 to 5 liters of milk over a 1 to 8 month period. So now, once we know that the mothers are eligible and they're willing to donate, then we have to look at the donor eligibility criteria. So these include a history of physical examination, and we have to look at their serological reports. So history-wise, they should not have any high-risk behaviors. They should not have had history of hepatitis, not have had a blood transfusion in the recent past, and they shouldn't be on any medications that are contraindicated during breastfeeding. They have to be healthy on examination, not suffering from any communicable diseases, and they should be willing to donate. What is also important that we need serological test reports, say HIV, their hepatitis B, their VDRL, and hepatitis C should be, the test report should be negative, and they should be documented by us on our case screening report form that it is negative. Now, as per the national guidelines, if the test has been done during the antenatal period, within 3 months when she plans to donate the milk, then we need not repeat the tests. Now, once we've identified the donor mothers, that they are eligible to donate, then the next important step is written informed consent. And it has to be in the local language. And the mother has to sign saying that she has been told that she can donate her breast milk, and this milk will be used after pasteurization for sick premature babies, and that she knows that by expressing that it's not going to interfere with the feeding of her own baby, and that she will not be given any remuneration for this feeding, for this milk that she is donating, and that she is happy to donate this milk. Now, once this procedure is planned, then of course comes the milk expression. And we've already discussed this. Dr. Archana already talked about milk expression. When a mother is expressing for her own baby, the best way is hand expression. But generally when she's expressing for, you know, donating her milk bank, then we prefer to use electric breast milk pumps. Why? Because you can use, you know, pump both breasts at the same time. You can adjust the pressure, then it, you know, so that it's comfortable for the mother. And it has actually what is called a stimulation and a ejection phase, these pumps, these electric pumps. And therefore, the yield of the milk is better. Now, these electric pumps, of course, are quite expensive. And so you get a various, you know, different types of of pumps that are available. You have the manually operated pumps, you have the battery operated pumps, and of course these hospital grade pumps. And like I said, if it's a small, milk bank, you don't have a very big budget, then hand expression is equally as good. But the hand expression has a technique that needs to be taught, and that is the job of the lactation counselors. Us healthcare providers who look after these mothers, all of us should definitely tell the mother about hand expression too. Now, if you're using electric pumps, the lactasets, and adequately sterilized lactasets, and you have to have a plan which kind of a container that you want to use. So you can use polypropylene containers, as you can see over here, or you can use glass containers or hard plastic. And for at least for the first 25 years that we were milk banking, this was the typical indigenous stainless steel containers with tight fitting caps that we have been using in our milk bank. Now, when you collect milk and you store the milk, even during the process of collection, you know that maintaining temperature and maintaining it cool is very important, because when the milk becomes warm, it could easily spoil and it could get contaminated by organisms. So if your milk collection area is different from the place where the milk is banked, in the actual milk bank, as it is in our institution, the bank is in one building and the milk collection areas are in the postnatal care wards, in the NICU and in the outpatient department. So there you need to have a refrigerator, preferably a dedicated refrigerator to store the milk till you transport the milk. So more normally milk collection is done between 9 and 12 in the mornings. And once it is collected, then it is sent in an insulated container with frozen gel packs to keep it cool, even while transporting from one building to the next. Once the milk comes to the milkman, then it is either stored in the refrigerator, if we plan to pasteurize the milk within the next 24 hours. But if you do not want to pasteurize, for example, if you run the pasteurizer only twice a week because of depending on the amount of milk that comes in, then it has to be stored in the deep freezer at minus 20 degrees centigrade. But what we need to remember is that when we pasteurize milk, and we have to use only pasteurized milk, distribute only pasteurized donor human milk, because only then it becomes safe. So when we pasteurize it, the milk has to be liquid. So if we store it in the deep freezer, then about 15 to 18 hours of generally the day before, we shift it to the refrigerator compartment, so that block of ice that the milk has become becomes liquefied again. And then the milk is subjected to pasteurization. So when we plan to pasteurize the milk, normally what we do is we actually cool the milk from 3 to 5 donors, because mothers will donate variable quantity of milk. It may be something as like 50 ml or 100 ml, or sometimes, you know, a good yield may be as much as 200 ml. So we generally cool the milk from 3 to 5 donors in a sterilized glass, a conical glass. And then we take one small sample, 1 ml in a culture test tube, in a sterile culture test tube, and send it for pre-pasteurization cultures. And then we distribute the milk into same sized sterile containers. We had 125 and 250 ml sterile containers. so that it becomes, you know, in the same volume of milk is present in each of the containers for pasteurization. So like I said, we pasteurize all the milk that we distribute to needy babies. And pasteurization is done by what is called the Holder pasteurization method. This method involves heating the milk to 62.5 degrees centigrade for 30 minutes, followed by rapid cooling to 4 degrees centigrade within a span of 30 minutes. So this helps to kill all the organisms, all the viruses, and in today's context, I should say, it helps to kill not only the HIV virus, but it also helps to kill the COVID virus. So there are various types of pasteurizers that are available in the markets. And this is the low cost technology that we were using for almost 25 years. That is called the shaker water bath. So this has an electronic you know, temperature regulator, and it has a gentle shaking device and a timer. So you fix up the time and fix up the temperature, and then it, by shaking them, because it is shaking, it causes an even distribution of heat and the milk gets heated up. But here the cooling has to be done manually by shifting out the containers into a slurry of ice and water. Today we use fully automated pasteurizers. Of course, imported pasteurizers are available, which are very expensive. And we worked with an international NGO called PATH, and we gave them the technical know-how, and with a company called KVC. And now we have indigenous pasteurizers in our country, which are much less expensive. But to keep in mind what Dr. Hemant said, that you don't have to have, if you're going to do a very small milk banking for a very small, NICU, then remember that heating the milk also would help, but you should be able to monitor the temperature of that heated milk, and it should not go above 62.5 degrees centigrade, because that would destroy the anti-infective factors in the milk. Now, once we've pasteurized the milk and pulled it, then we take another sample from each of the containers and send it again for microbiological testing. This is important to ensure the safety of donor human milk. Now, so we look at both the pre-pasteurization report as well as the post-pasteurization report. If the pre-pasteurization report shows more than 10 raised to 4 colony-forming organisms of pathogenic organisms, more than 10 raised to 5 of skin commensals, then we would discard this milk, even if it if the post-pasteurization culture is negative, because we're dealing with tiny preterm babies, so we don't want to take any risk. And post-pasteurization, of course, the milk has to be totally organism-free. Even if there's a slight growth, then the milk has to be discarded. So if you want to avoid the discarding and wastage of human milk, what is very important is for any milk bank or for any milk collection, we have to be very particular about how this milk is collected, the sterilization of the NACTA sets in which the milk is pumped out, the sterilization of the container, and the whole process of handling the milk has to be done as aseptically as possible. And once we've sent out the cultures, when we store the milk in the deep freezer at minus 20 degrees centigrade, normally we store the raw milk that is waiting pasteurization in the milk that is pasteurized, where the reports are awaited in the different shelves of the same freezer. And once we get the reports, when we shifted the safe milk into another freezer from where the milk is then distributed. When we distribute the milk, it is done on a first in, first out basis. Milk that comes in earlier goes out earlier. Now, remember that the shelf life of pasteurized donor human milk is as much as 6 months. But of course, in our own hospital, generally, the turnover is very fast and we utilize it within 1 to 2 months at the most if we have a lot of milk that is coming in. Now, it has to be, the distribution to the unit has to be done based on the prescription. So the nurse will tell us roughly how many containers of 125 or 250 ml they think they require for the unit. And then when we send the ice box and it's kept in the refrigerator if it's to be used within 24 hours, or in the deep freezer if it's over the weekend, and then taken out and shifted to the refrigerator compartment. Before feeding, we have now a warming unit, but otherwise you can stand the container in warm water, so that it warms up a little bit to body temperature. And once this milk has been warmed up, we should use it preferably within 2 and not more than later than 4 hours. And of course, it has to be used after written informed consent. So who are the recipients of this banked milk? So the recipients are basically, you have to prioritize, and the most vulnerable group are the very preterm, the very low birth weight babies, less than 1500 grams. In today's COVID times, we've actually had to tweak our require and this thing, and we give it to babies only less than 1250 grams because the number of mothers who are able to donate now are lessened. Then if you have more milk, then of course you can liberalize it, and then the low birth, the growth retarded babies, those babies who are at risk for hypoglycemia, babies of mothers who have problems, severe eclampsia, postpartum hemorrhage, couple 2-3 days, 1 week, till the baby, till the mother is in a position to feed. Babies in the surgical NICU recovering from gastrointestinal surgeries and so on and so forth would be the recipients for banked milk. So this is a nutshell human milk banking. If you look at the cost of setting up a human milk bank, it can vary from a very minimal cost to a large cost, and depending on the type of equipment that you purchase. And like Dr. Hemant said, that on a very small scale, it should be possible in association with even a small NICU in a small nursing home, and you can keep it small and you can keep it simple. But being able to use human milk will help save all your preterm babies. But before I end, I'd just like to speak a few words on helping working mothers successfully breastfeed, because Dr. Archan had specifically said that cover this aspect of it. So like already Dr. Archan and Dr. Hemant have told us how they struggled to get 6 months maternity leave. So yes, every mother should get the benefit of 6 months maternity leave, because by the time the baby is completed 6 months, complementary feeding can be started. So that gives her a little more leeway. In today's day and age, one of the positive fallout of the COVID pandemic is being able to work from home. And let's hope this facility continues for working mothers post-COVID. If that is not possible, at least flexi timings is something that is important. So mother-friendly workplaces should make it possible for mothers to have flexi timing. And of course, the workplace should be friendly. There should be a place where mothers are able to sit and comfortably express milk, the typical Hirkani Kaksh, which Prashant has spearheaded in our country. Now, when mothers have to go back to work, what would we recommend is that they start pumping milk, have something like a small milk bank at home itself. They start pumping milk at least a month in advance before they go start working. Of course, they need to use strict hygienic procedures, hand washing, and if they're using milk pumps, then proper sterilization of the kits and the container. Then when they express milk, say you express in the morning, collect it into a container, put it into the refrigerator. The next milk, warm milk that she expresses, which is at her body temperature, should not be mixed with the cold milk, but she should cool it before pooling. So they pool the two containers together only after they're cooled. At the end of the day, store this milk in small aliquots, label it properly, label the date, and then keep it in the deep freezer. And when the mother is at home, before going for work, after she returns from work on holidays, she must continue to give unrestricted demand feeding so as to maintain her milk supply. Let's talk a little bit about what about the storage of this milk? What is the various time intervals for storage? So suppose a mother expresses milk and then her mother-in-law is going to feed it. She expresses just before she goes. Then this fresh milk can be stored at room temperature, that is below 25 degrees centigrade, not the hot temperatures of Nagpur or sometimes Mumbai, which becomes 36 and 40 degrees centigrade, because milk can spoil easily. So the warmer the temperature, the shorter period it should be outside. If you keep it in an insulated container with frozen gel packs, and it can last for 24 hours. If you store milk in the refrigerator, if it's freshly expressed milk, it can stay for an average of 4 days. But if it's thawed frozen milk, then once it is thawed completely, it should not be kept for more than 24 hours. If you store it in the freezer compartment of the refrigerator, then you can store it for 3 to 6 months for a term baby. For milk bank, we would store it in the deep freezer, a dedicated deep freezer. And if you store it, if you have a dedicated deep freezer at home, then your milk is as good, can be stored safely for 6 to 12 months. So this is storing milk at home. Like we said, it should be a mother-friendly workplace with the Hirkani Kaksha type of arrangement. Mother should pump milk in their lunch break, at tea breaks, and then keep it in either packs that are, bags that are, milk collection bags that are online, or in small plastic or glass containers. You can put it in the refrigerator if it's a leak-proof container, or in the freezer so it becomes easier to carry. And then once she carries it home in an ice box and then puts it into the fridge or the refrigerator.
Yeah.
Regarding thawing and feeding them, never microwave the milk, never heat this milk before feeding. And sometimes the fat separates out, so you need to swirl the bottle a little bit gently so that the milk mixes in again. And always feed with a vati or a vati spoon or a cup of bomla. Never feed with a feeding bottle. And another thing is that once you've fed the milk, whatever you've taken out, and you've thawed the milk, then do not refreeze it, do not feed it again, discard. So what is very important for us to do is to give these tiny treasures the best start in life, give them their own mother's milk, and whenever that's not possible, supplement it with pasteurized donor human milk from the human milk bank and with kangaroo mother care. Even your tiny babies will do very well. Thank you very much for the patient here.
Thank you, Jayashree. Thank you so much. Now we have our last speaker, Dr. Shashivani. Respected Madam Shashivani, to start. She's going to talk on kangaroo mother care. Dr. Shashivani? Madam Shashivani? Dr. Shashivani? Hemant, start karto. Hello? Can you all hear me?
Yes, we can hear you. Dr. Vani needs to remove the mute on her mic.
Yes, you spoke very well, you know, covered all the points. Good, good, good. Especially about the working mothers.
Yashri, madam, you create a document for us which we can send to 4,000, 4 lakh villages and they can start in their way a breast milk bank.
Definitely.
Help us to do that. Small document.
Yes, sure.
Yeah, madam. Everybody put their mics on mute mode now. Madam is starting.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to be with you all. And I have learned a lot of things here. Let me accept that first. And we will go for this. Now, first and foremost thing, the topic given to me is kangaroo baby care. Of course, kangaroo baby care, but we now conventionally call it kangaroo mother care. I will explain to you, because kangaroo mother care, kangaroo care includes supporting breast milk as much as possible, promoting exclusive breast milk, early breastfeeding, and that is one of the best interventions to start early initiation of breast milk. And that is why conventionally, only mother can give breast milk for the baby. And that is why kangaroo mother care, that terminology is used. It is for the babies, no doubt. But conventionally, we use the term to impress the importance of breastfeeding that is attached with the incorporated within the kangaroo mother care. Now with this, I'll go to the we have started a foundation mainly to promote breastfeeding and kangaroo mother care, and of course newborn care with a focus through this. And our slogan is mother's chest is the best place for the newborn care. Earlier we were saying rooming in with the mother. Now we said bedding in with the mother, baby, and now we are shifting the baby from bed to mother's chest. Even for the sick babies also, now it has been internationally acknowledged that it is the best place for care. And mother's milk, of course, all of you have now sufficiently recognized that it is the best food for the newborn. And the third slogan which we have now added is zero separation of mother and her baby. As far as possible, unless you are doing some life-saving interventions or for some immediate urgent intervention, you have to separate the baby, yes. But just for observation, because it's a high-risk baby, it is a cesarean baby, it is a twins, it is a meconium strain like her, or any such pretense on which earlier with good intention we were separating, but now we have learned that separation is much worse for the baby and the mother. So try to keep them as much as possible. So zero separation is the other concept. And Kangaroo Mother Care has to be incorporated in our routine care of all the newborns, not to be considered something special, something different, and only for low birth weight baby. That concept is also now changing, including for the term babies. It is being introduced. Term babies also have certain advantages. Only thing is, term babies will not prefer to stay in kangaroo state for few hours or more than few days. But even within the few hours, wherever we have put the baby on mother's chest, babies have had so many advantages. So that is the background with which we are starting. Now, kangaroo mother care, now most of the people have known, but still people carry the concept, many of them, that it many still do not know about kangaroo care. And those who know it, many still carry the impression that it is only for a method of preventing hypothermia. Even the professors, I have heard them introducing the subject that it is one of the best method for preventing hypothermia. But now we have evolved into saying that it is a comprehensive method of care of the newborns with a special benefit to low birth weight babies. And in hospitals, because of the overcrowding, we are not able to admit all the babies up to 2,500 grams. So now we give preference to babies less than 2,000 grams. So many people ask me question, why you mentioned 2,000 grams? That is because of the overcrowding. And majority of our newborns are in the group of 2,000 to 2,500 grams. They can be taught, instructed, counseled, and they can continue the same skin-to-skin contact at home also. So that is the next background I wanted to say, that please learn that it is a comprehensive method of care of the newborn. Even in the manuals for the developmentally supportive care, 1,000 days care, and even in the breastfeeding promotion, it is only casually mentioned. So the full emphasis has to be given now. It is one of the best intervention for the earliest good start for the breast milk feeding, breastfeeding. Now, what is kangaroo care? So we describe it as it's a human, low-cost, evidence-based, high-impact, standardized method of care with special benefits to low birth weight infant. Here, I would like to add one more thing. Just because we mention low cost, many people just brush it aside. Oh, it is meant only for the poor people. So now we have also added another one. This is through the international expert group that it is low cost, but high skill, high impact, and highly evidence-based care. So that is, it should give the viewers that it is one of the important subjects to learn. And just because holding the baby on chest, don't take it for granted that everything is known. So many small little details have to be known for successful thing. And then, of course, it is a method of holding the baby directly on skin-to-skin contact on mother's chest, in between her breasts, without any layers of clothing in between her and the mother, with slightly extended neck for the baby in as much vertical position as possible so that mother and baby can have eye-to-eye contact. And this position is important even to maintain open airways. And most important is at this vertical position, because many times we do kangaroo care for extremely low birth weight babies and very preterm babies. And many times they do not have proper control to prevent regurgitation of milk from food pipe to the windpipe. And in these cases, many times if the position is not maintained, there might be regurgitation of the milk. It might enter into respirations and create problems. And that is why, as far as possible, a vertical position to be maintained and eye-to-eye contact with mother and baby is very important. And where it is not possible, especially in the centers where they are treating even the micro preemies, that is babies less than even 600 gram, 700 gram. They even give a mirror to the mother so that she can have a constant look to the baby. And from above, both the mother and baby should be covered together. And in our language,
ma'am,
yes,
ma'am, please can you share the PPT?
Yes, yes. Can I proceed?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes. You are able to see it?
No, ma'am, we are not able to see it. You have to share the screen so that we can see it.
I shared it. I don't know.
Okay. Ma'am, down there is an option where there are icons mute, stop video, and green icon share content.
No, but that is not it coming up.
Okay. No problem, ma'am. Continue.
No, no, I wanted the visuals. Can you just give me 1 minute?
Yeah.
Sure, ma'am.
Whenever I do the share screen, yes, share.
Yeah, now it is.
Learn a bit. Not this one. Just give me 1 minute.
Yeah, ma'am. Yeah, madam.
Sure, ma'am.
Prashant can help. Can Prashant from Centaur help?
Ma'am,
morning it worked well. Now are you able to see?
Ma'am, yes, we can see your screen. You can open the PPT.
I have opened. I can see it.
Not visible.
I can see it.
Okay. Here it is not. You need to.
Dr. Prashant can start from his side.
Stop share. I can share from my side. You please stop share.
Okay.
Prashant, you share now.
Yeah, I am.
Because morning we worked it well.
What is the problem?
Hello? I'm projecting from here, but
now it is visible, right?
Yeah, for me it is fine.
Yes, it's visible.
The lights are visible, right?
Yes.
Yes, the slides are visible now.
Yeah. Which slide, madam, now?
Start with the first one. Quickly we'll pass through.
Okay.
So, second one. So, this is the slogan I was telling you, that mother's chest is the best place for the newborn care. So, even from the rooming in, bedding in, now we are promoting the baby on mother's chest. So, that is the one thing I wanted to say. And especially for the low birth weight and preterm babies, because they have to be given mother's milk as much as possible. And then, of course, mother's milk is the best food. This group knows it. And zero separation also, I told. And this is mainly for our doctor colleagues, that don't separate the mother just because from her baby, just because you wanted to observe. And much more important in this COVID era, as far as possible, even in the COVID positive mothers, or when the status is not known, please try to keep the baby with the mother. There are so many advantages against the possible threat of transmission to the baby and baby getting problems. And kangaroo mother care should be considered as a part of the routine care, not something special. And this is all the things I am saying. Please know that kangaroo mother care is a method of comprehensive care, not just a method of preventing only hypothermia. Next one. And it can, And low cost doesn't mean it is to be meant for only for the poor people. Low cost, high skill, high impact, evidence based, and it has got relevance even in the best of the centers, even internationally, best centers, Scandinavian countries and others, with the lowest mortality rates and best care, everything free of charge, but still they are trying to promote Kangar Mother Care. Next. And this also we have said how to do it. Keep the baby in between mother's chest and of course the slight position. And here I wanted to say that rather than calling it as mere skin to skin contact, conveying some superficial touch, keep the baby on mother's chest. That means you are giving a loving hug. Yeah. So many mothers' emotions are transmitted to the baby, and that have got many more advantages than only the breast milk or the skin to skin touch. So that is a very important concept, and many countries in their local language they use a term which means loving hug. So in our group, we used to introduce Mamta ki Jappi, Jadui Jappi, or Prem Bharyo Alingan. When we started this, all this Munna Bhai series were very popular. So that Jappi came up very handy to us. Next. And then WHO says it should be started as early as possible, give as frequently and as prolonged as possible, and as continuous as possible, and that has got the better impact. And it should be, and only holding the baby on mother's chest alone is not Kangar Mother Care. It should be combined with exclusive breastfeeding whenever possible. So each one has to make his own audit, whether I could have improved something more to promote much more earlier the breastfeeding. Because we are talking about very preterm babies, very low birth weight babies, this self-auditing is very, very important. And then, of course, planned early discharge. Here, the term I would like to add. Early discharge with adequate follow-up and support. Kangaroo care is not the care only in the hospital. The continued support at home and regularly planned, scheduled follow-up. Because, again, we are talking about the preterm and low birth weight babies, where the neurodevelopment also has to be assessed, ROP testing has to be done, hearing testing has to be done, and all the developmentally supportive care follows throughout. So it includes all this component. And then, of course, the one more thing, it should be initiated in the practice in the facility and continued at home till the baby decides not to have any more Kangaroo care. So this early discharge, I would like to qualify that in our countries, now that government is promoting institutional deliveries, they are happening. But mothers do not stay in the hospital till we desire to stay them. So we have to at least counsel them, make them practice, supervise them, guide them, and then send them home, even when the baby is not achieved the ideal weight. But at least if the baby is showing some constant weight gain, mother has learned the technique, she is confident of that, family members are willing to give her all the support and a certain other criteria, then we discharge the baby, and that we call it as planned discharge against random discharge. So that concept also is to be understood very well. And just for interest, to remember the things, I would like to say this care started in South America in a city, Bogota. They also had by two pediatricians, Edgar Ray Sanabria and Hector Martinez. Next one. And these people also had similar problems to like us. 33,000 deliveries, public hospital, catering to poor people. And as per the protocol, only the low birth weight babies and preterm babies were admitted in the NICUs. Mothers were kept outside, babies were inside. So first of all, mothers had worried, mothers were not allowed to visit the babies, breast milk suffered, and those in the hospital also, less staff, less equipment, more babies, cross-infection rate increased, breast milk suffered, formula milk, it had its problems, so that problems were there. Even with this background, those babies could not be admitted because of the overcrowding, they died outside because of the hypothermia. So to prevent hypothermia, this concept was introduced. they saw their local mother, grandmothers carrying the babies. Only difference they made it is changing the local practice a little bit. Mothers or grandmothers who were carrying the babies on their chest or their back, which, you know, even in our country, we have that thing. They just remove the clothing in between the baby and mother so that the mother's heat can be directly transmitted to the baby. And then they found not only these babies who remained with their mother outside the unit, they could grow well, but they sometimes grew much better than those babies who were inside. And then they analyzed why it was so. Here the mothers were stress-free and naturally they had their babies all the time with them. They could start breastfeeding as early as possible. They could feed the babies as much as possible. And because one mother was taking care of one baby, infection rate was much less, and all the protective mechanism from the breast milk also came to the mother. And then they were very confidently introduced this method. Please go back to the slides, please. When I tell you, you please change. So then they introduced, yeah, remain here. So then they introduced this concept to the whole world. People were not ready to believe them. They came, they studied, convinced, and then the method spread. So that is why, because the mother was holding the baby on chest, similar to a kangaroo holding on the abdomen, they called it as kangaroo care. So mother baby were together, direct skin to skin contact, warmth was given to the baby, and breastfeeding was promoted, and zero separation of mother and baby. Next. So in our country also, when we introduced kangaroo care, many people in the beginning could not identify what is kangaroo, especially in the communities, rural areas, remote areas, tribal areas, when we wanted to introduce that. And there many times electricity was also not there. We could not project videos. And that side, next slide. We introduced simply the other concept. See, the monkeys are carrying their babies. And they also carry chest to chest, skin to skin. They also breastfeed. They give the birth. They carry for the transport. And immediately that clicked. But to keep it with the international chronology, we have promoted the word kangaroo care. And now conventionally, as I said, even in the international group, they said we should use the word kangaroo mother care because mother produces breast milk and breast milk is promoted through kangaroo care. So kangaroo mother care. If it is given by father, father kangaroo care, grandmother kangaroo care, community kangaroo care, but that KMC should retain. Next. So, in 1996, they had the first international conference, and very quickly it picked up with many centers. And we introduced in India from 1993-94, and we submitted our first paper also in the international conference. And immediately in the second international conference at Bogota in 1998, they could boldly declare that it should be a basic right for every newborn and should be an integral part of management for all the newborns, including term babies. Kindly note this. And in all settings, not meant only for the deprived areas or remote areas or poor areas, in all the settings, even in the best of the developed countries also. Next. So with this background, I would now want to introduce why we want to promote kangaroo care in our country. Just briefly, we have got more than 27 million births, world records, highest number of births, highest incidence of low birth rate, highest number of neonatal deaths, highest number of maternal deaths, highest number of stillbirths, anything you call highest in number-wise, nobody can beat us. The next four or five countries together also, they cannot match us. So that is the situation we have. But at the same time, we have a lot of difference between urban area, rural area, rich area, poor area, male, female, and region to region. Kerala has a different mortality, Madhya Pradesh has a different mortality. So many diversities are there. So we have best of the care available, but at the same time, there is a lot of diversity. Next. And as I said, most of our preterm babies, almost 80%, they constitute the bulk of our neonatal mortality. And most of them, they died due to easily preventable causes. That is sepsis and some of the complications following prematurity, which can be easily tackled. And another background which we have highest number of low birth weight babies. Naturally, they require more care, and we have less staff and less facilities. At least after this, we have now got more than 800 SNCUs in the different district levels, and they are trying to improve kangaroo care. They are trying to improve the newborn care, and there also now we are introducing this concept. So in short, next. And this is evidence bears because in 2005 in Lancet neonatal series, they gave one very good studied evidence-based statement, globally considered, that in developing countries like India with very high neonatal mortality, combined with weak public systems and inadequate facilities, simple interventions like breastfeeding promotion, kangaroo mother care, hand washing, and other infection prevention measures and some of the harmful traditional practices, even if we can tackle them well, we can reduce our mortality considerably. Not that everywhere ventilators are required, surfactants are required, nitric oxide is required, and all the equipment are required. They are required, they have a role, but we need not feel shy about these simple things. And why I am emphasizing, at least for past 50 years or more, we have been conducting the same breastfeeding promotion message. One or two might have altered, but still we find early initiation at national level is barely in 40 to 50% and exclusive breastfeeding rate. At that time, we were talking 4 months, now it is 6 months, but that has also not reached 50%. So only if quality coverage is there, and 90% quality and quantity-wise coverage is there, then the impact will be felt. Otherwise, it will boomerang. People, after a few years, might feel, oh, we are doing so much, nothing is felt. Just like institutional deliveries. We thought it will create magic, but institutional deliveries increase, but parallel improvement in newborn care has not happened. So with this background, now they have shown the same thing with the studies. Breastfeeding has got level 5 evidence that it has the potential to reduce 55 to 87% of mortality. Now, of course, we have come with the other thing. And kangaroo care, not only it prevents hypothermia, it improves breastfeeding, it reduces infection, and so many things. So cumulatively, it has got a very, very high impact, provided proper quality and proper coverage is there. Next. So with this brief bag, and same thing now, Cochrane review, the highest evidence base, which we all accept in the scientific language, they have also accepted that KMC does reduce mortality significantly and prevents hypothermia infection. And another thing, it has to be as much as possible, continuous KMC, and started within 10 days of birth, the impact is much better, and it definitely improves the exclusive breastfeeding rate. Next. And quickly passing, and immediately skin-to-skin contact. Now, this is something we have been talking about, but we have to learn properly. WHO has now recommended all the babies, only excepting those requiring immediate life-saving interventions, all the other babies, irrespective of their birth weight, irrespective of their gestation age, soon after birth, immediately they have to be put on mother's body. Before cutting the cord, sometimes if the length is not sufficient, even on mother's thigh or lower abdomen, the baby can be kept. And then once we decide the cord cutting, now we are promoting delayed cord cutting. As soon as you cut the cord, then quickly dry the baby and shift the baby to mother's chest. Even before the placenta is out, even before you have examined, even before you have taken the weight, vitamin K has been given. There is no hurry for all that. Yes, that many are doing, but it is done only for a few minutes. That also has to be now changed. If mother and baby are comfortable, or if there is somebody to help the mother to keep the baby on chest, in that case, try to keep the baby at least continuously for minimum of 1 hour. And now they have extended, if possible, extend it for 2 hours. And that has got several benefits now. I don't have the scientific evidence right now to tell you, but it has several benefits, including, first of all, physiological stability of the baby is there. Early stabilization of heart rate, respiration rate, and improving the oxygen saturation, preventing hypothermia, and naturally promoting breast milk secretion. So these are all the three things, and much more important, improving the bonding, which will cumulatively help to promote breastfeeding and continue the successful breastfeeding. So right now I said, kangaroo mother care or this early skin to skin contact has to be considered as the first step, the earliest initiation of breast milk production. Now this skin to skin contact, again I'm repeating, ideally, it should be kept for at least 1 to 2 hours. Just keeping for a few minutes, it may not have all the benefits. And by itself, if it is not kept for more than 1 hour, that should not be interpreted as kangaroo mother care. It is only early skin-to-skin contact. If it is prolonged and preferably combined with breast crawl or any other attempts for promoting breast milk, whether the baby gets breast milk or not, apparently, but still, if some promotion is done, only then you call it as kangaroo mother care. Next. So kangaroo mother care, as I already said, it has three major components. Keeping the baby on mother's chest is kangaroo position. Promoting breast milk as much as possible is kangaroo nutrition. Planned early discharge with regular scheduled follow-up, including neurodevelopment, that is kangaroo discharge and follow-up. Even at national guidelines, this third component is not given that much attention. And that too in a supportive environment, both in the hospital as well as at home. Now, right now, Dr. Prashant also told you, give them a happy family-like atmosphere in the hospital also with good behavior and good support so that they are encouraged to do all these things. And same thing should be continued at home. Next one. So the same thing we are saying, kangaroo position, kangaroo nutrition discharge. Next one, regular follow-up. And if follow-up is not possible in the centers.
Ma'am, can't hear you.
Yeah? No, my mic is on here. Now, are you able to hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, madam. Yes,
yeah.
Ma'am.
And post-discharge home-based KMC has to be continued at home. And for follow-up, I said in I don't know. I can't help it from here.
We can hear you. We can hear you, ma'am.
So somebody says they are not able to hear. Is it okay?
It's okay, ma'am.
Should I come closer?
Yes. No, ma'am. Absolutely fine.
Okay. So that regular follow-up, if it is not possible in the designated centers, you have now developmental intervention centers, or now we train our community health workers to identify problems even at homes. Or we have now given them a designated follow-up center. And at least for the preterm babies with certain provisions, we expect them to have their ROP checked and also hearing checked, and neurodevelopmental follow-up also. And of course, post-discharge home-based KMC to be continued. The common question asked is how long? How long means as long as the baby is comfortable on mother's chest, continue it. There is no definite time factor or there is no definite gestation factor. Most of the times, the babies have to decide around 40 weeks of gestation or around 2,500 grams weight, generally babies live. Some babies may go on up to 42 weeks also, or some babies even after that, soon after birth or during nighttime, they would like to have some kangaroo care. So that is the thing, and family has to give a lot of support to them. Next. So supporting environment, we said, and at home mainly in what way they can help. First of all, they can help in her regular daily course at home, looking after children and other activities. They can even act as alternate kangaroo care providers, and they can even help mother with regular follow-up. Next. Next. benefits of Kangaroo Mother. Please go for the previous one. So lot of benefits are there, but as you say, improving the brain development and improving mother-baby bonding and improving breastfeeding and growth, and of course preventing hypothermia and other things, preventing infection. There are so many things. The most important thing is it satisfies all the five sensations of the baby. Next one. And all these benefits are not only for immediate needs, even long-term benefits have also been noted. Last year, studies have been published from original Bogota Center that even after 20 years, those babies whom they can trace who had satisfactory kangaroo mother care, their behavior, their development was much different than those babies who did not have. And now here, breastfeeding or no feeding, babies who are held on mother's chest, and so many sensations are simultaneously stimulated, improving and strengthening the synaptogenesis, and that improves the brain development. Next one. And this is all supported by studies. So now what we prefer, as far as possible, keep the baby on mother's chest. Baby is calm, mother is calm, baby's brain is calm, body is calm, and all that helps for minimizing the baby's expenditure sent and developmentally support care and emotional attachment. So now centers have promoted that along with the babies in NICUs, you admit even the mothers in the NICUs. So as much as possible, even the procedures can be done on baby, can be done with the baby on mother, so that baby feels the pain also much less, and mother's bonding also continues. She also learns a lot, and babies get a lot of benefit. Even those babies on mechanical ventilator, they are found. Those who are on mother's chest and given mechanical ventilator, they needed the ventilation for much less time. Their oxygen consumption improved, apneic attacks decreased, and so many cardiopulmonary benefits have occurred. So now they have come to a paradigm shift that earlier we started using kangaroo care because the incubators were not available. But now we should go to a state that only when kangaroo mother care is not possible due to something, only then you shift the baby for incubators. So that is the paradigm shift now we want to achieve. And many centers have already achieved it. And if they can do it, we can also do it. Next one. So when the baby is in the incubator, you know, strange sounds, scary smells, bright lights, and many centers do not have the diurnal changes also. They do not allow rest period. And all the time the baby is in a stress mode. And avoid pathways are stimulated, sympathetic pathways are stimulated, extra energy is spent, so hypoglycemia is also much more, apnea is also much more, naturally interventions and procedures are much more, and it leads to a vicious thing. So all that can be prevented by putting the baby on mother's chest. Next. And now mother also gets the benefit, mainly her postpartum depression and that also reduced. But most important is, if we have trained in the hospital itself, her self-esteem in taking care of her baby improves. Otherwise, generally what happens, as long as the baby is in ICU, you give the best care. But then you just hand over the baby to mother, and then she doesn't know what to do at home. And then she comes back with complications. So now we have introduced the concept of family-centered care, and along with that, at least for the preterm and low birth weight babies, you introduce her with the kangaroo mother care, so that she is now confident that, yes, I will be able to continue the same care at home also. So her confidence improves, her competence improves, and her self-esteem improves, and that helps a lot in successful care even at home. Next. And naturally, the family also benefited in so many. Their involvement in this baby's care improves. It is not just mother and baby's business. Everybody is interested, and everybody is interested positively. Some of the harmful traditional practices are not forced upon the mother. And of course, cost of hospitalization, feeding, formula, everything reduces, and so many benefits are there. Next. and early developmental interventions start. Hospitals also benefit. Earlier, people thought by keeping the baby in kangaroo care, the incubator charges, oxygen charges, everything we are losing money. But now we are, those who have started practicing, they are convinced that in terms of staff, equipment, oxygen, medicine, formula, so many ways the cost of care is reduced. And most best instalment is the family comes back to you for regular follow-up and they recommend you for others to come to you. And then naturally, community also benefits. Here, that slide is missing. But most important intervention in the community is they propagate this thing. There is no stigma attached to having a baby preterm because in some of the African countries, those mothers who have a preterm baby immediately a stigma attached to them. So that also is wiped off and many benefits are happening. And traditional, harmful traditional practices have rapidly start disappearing. That is more important. And naturally, the nation benefits. They get a healthier and intelligent babies, and scant resources are also diverted to the needy people, and staff members are also diverted. Next. So with all this background of benefits, now we know one slide only I'm putting. What is the mechanism by which so many benefits are occurring? There are so many neuroendocrine things are happening, hormonal changes are happening. But one thing which is coming out is oxytocin, which is stimulated in multiple places, both by skin-to-skin touch in the baby as well as in the mother. It gives so many benefits. And of course, other endocrines and all, they help you. So oxytocin stimulates the parasympathetic mode, which leads to anti-stress, anti-inflammatory, better immunity, better survival, analgesic effects, sedation effect, neurodevelopment, and of course, preventing hypothermia, baby cries less, and temperature synchrony and all that is achieved. This itself will take a long time, but basically, you know, kangaroo care is supported by the various studies also. Next. Next. So now what practical things we should do? When you're putting the baby on mother's chest, as soon as possible, many hospitals, just before discharge, they put the baby on mother's chest and then tick it off. Yes, kangaroo care given. No. As soon as possible, you should put the baby soon after birth. And you can decide, depending on your staff, depending on your expertise, depending on your involvement, you can even extend it to the sick babies also, mildly sick babies also, preterm babies also. So you can form your own policy. Generally, to be safe, we are saying all the stabilized low birth weight babies you put. But that stabilization could be continued with nasogastric feeding, could be continued with IV feeding, could be continued with minimal oxygen, even with phototherapy also. So that can be definitely promoted in SNCUs. But in tertiary care units, intensive care units, they can even extend their thing. And even babies who are on CPAP, even babies on mechanical ventilator, all that also you can try. Next. Zero separation, as I said, maximum possible level, we have to remember. And who can provide KMC? Mother, of course, is best, but we want prolonged KMC, so somebody should help her. And if she is not available, other family members can also help her. And especially father, grandmother, or some places, even the hospital staff is also helping the mothers. Neighbors are also helping, friends are also helping, provided they have also been trained how to do it well with hand washing and all infection prevention measures. And they also know how to early identification of danger signals. Next. Next, please. So mothers are the best one. And then you put all these charts in your thing, how to do it. You have to make sure that they do it properly. Hand washing, proper personal hygiene, only wash clothes, preparing the baby under clean, warmer area, putting the baby on mother's chest. If available, a kangaroo bag can be there. Next. Or some wrap by which mother can be confident in holding the baby safely so that the baby doesn't fall. She can even walk around a bit, give all the comfortable position to the mother so she is motivated to continue it for more than 2-3 hours at a time. We don't expect her to do 8 hours, 10 hours without break. She has to have some obligatory breaks. Baby also has to have some break for examination, diaper change, or when the baby is on express breast milk, top milk, some breaks will be there. But we have to make an audit and make sure how more we can improve the thing. And you can even give some relaxation to the mothers so that they can motivated to hold the babies on you. Give them some precautions. At least all the time they should give support to the back of the baby so that the baby doesn't suddenly flex and create complications. Next. And all these we are doing in training modules and conducting for 2 days, 3 days. And as I said, babies can be done with triplets, twin. Even one mother can hold both the twins on her, sick baby, CPAP baby. You can expand your scope. Next. And then you can do it with your available thing. Everywhere, the Fowler bed is not required or special chairs are not required with pillows, cushions or simple backrest or even on the floor with the wall base. Even at homes also we are promoting. And especially now in Maharashtra, we have promoted home-based kangaroo care and hopefully we are trying to get some good results. Next. And in one sitting, how long you can hold the baby? That is an important thing. Everywhere the literature mentions 1 hour minimum. But we are now adding from our experience to achieve that effective 1 hour. If you say 1.5 hours, that effective 1 hour is achieved. So that is why you have to tell 1 hour. 1.5 hour, if you say, by the time the baby is taken on mother's chest, mother adjusts to herself and fixes, and then baby is quietly adjusting, it takes a few minutes. So give all that allowance and say 1.5 hours so that effective 6 minutes are achieved. Why that 60 minutes, 1 hour? Because the baby, once the baby is put on mother's chest, baby gets a deep, quiet sleep. And you would have seen, wherever the baby is on kangaroo care, they are quiet. They are lying on baby and mother and having a comfortable sleep. And that sleep promotes a good cycle of, one good cycle is at least for 60 minutes. And to make her achieve that good cycle of sleep, we want her to do it for 1.5 hours so that effective 1 hour we are assured. And during that 1 hour, baby's brain growth occurs. Her sensory system develops, her neuroplasticity is improved, and so many benefits are achieved. And that rest period is very important. And on mother's chest with all the comfort, no stress, and that is important. Otherwise, for half an hour, every 10 minutes, we improve the baby for say some investigation, some examination, something. All that is very stressful to the baby. So that cluster care is very important and give the good time for the baby to complete a good sleep cycle. Next. And if you explain this to the mothers, their compliance and their support is very much there. So sleep and sleep cycle, I have said. Next. And initially, if the baby is very sick, you can even start in NICU with 1 or 2 hours with long intervals, which we call it intermittent KMC. Once the baby is stable, next one. Even that intermittent few hours KMC also has got benefits both to the mother and baby. And then once they stabilize, you shift them to designated wards or places where mothers can continue to have this. And now government has also promoted mother and newborn care units, where even the mothers who are not delivered in your hospital, still they can be admitted. And even the babies who are not 1,800 grams or up to 2,000 grams also can be admitted here. Because in SNCU, generally they admit only less than 1,800 grams and only those mothers who are delivered in the hospital. But now government has made this provision and some budget allocation is also there. Next. So continuous KMC is very helpful. To make them do continuous KMC, you do not expect the mother all the time only to hold the baby. So she can be allowed reading papers, she can be allowed some craft thing, she can be allowed play, she can eat along with that, she can see some watch TV also. Don't put only educational slides or TV programs. Put some entertaining, good movies also, so that mother is stimulated to watch them for a longer time. Next. And effective counseling at multiple stages is required. Start counseling with right messages from the antenatal period, then just before delivery, then just before she is about to start kangaroo care, during her kangaroo care to improve her timing for the duration of kangaroo care, improve her breastfeeding, answer all concerns just before discharge, to make sure that she has learned things properly and she will come to you for follow-up or where she has to go for follow-up, all these things. So at minimum 6 level of counseling we have prescribed, and that should be, we should try for that. Next. And then scope which we have. As I said, generally we know, we start with the term babies also with early skin-to-skin contact. Term babies will leave within 2-3 days at the most. But even then it is beneficial. Most of the times we continue it for the preterm and low birth weight baby. And low birth weight includes IUGR babies, term babies also, and preterm babies also. And even sick babies with IV lines, oxygen, CPAP. And now I said some of the centers, at least in abroad, many of the centers are now trying even with the mechanical ventilators. Now during transport, we can definitely introduce newborn care. Some countries have now got it as a legalized obligation even on the healthcare team. When they carry the baby from home to hospital also, they should carry them on kangaroo care. If no family member is available, the health team will provide the kangaroo care. And even those babies who are taken for operation for congenital heart disease and other things, they are also supposed to carry them. Even in helicopters also, they have made provision. But at least in our country, where the mothers have been admitted in the hospital and going back home, we ask them to carry the baby on kangaroo care because she has learned the technique under our observation. Then the reverse transport will occur. When she comes to you for follow-up, she will be motivated to carry the baby and she will also know how to safely carry the baby in kangaroo care. So she will come back to you. Then now we are planning to prepare a guideline and even a module for baby transport also. Post-discharge continuation, as I said, home-based KMC. Home-based KMC can be there in 3 different modules. If time limit is there, now you please tell me. Otherwise, I'll take another 5 minutes. Is it okay? Otherwise, first I can conclude with this. Please tell me.
Take 5 minutes. You can take 5 minutes, ma'am.
Okay, only in that. So we have scope for sick babies, post-discharge continuation at home. Here I wanted to say, home-based KMC has got 3 major groups, just like home-based newborn care. Those who delivered in the hospital, those who were trained in the hospital for some time, then they had planned discharge, and then they had to go home and continue the care. So in that case also, if the baby is still requiring kangaroo mother care, we want them to continue. Now the major group is there in our country, because the institutional deliveries have increased, mothers come there because there are so many other incentives are given to them, cash incentives are given them. And even if mother doesn't want to come, others force her to come for hospital delivery. And in that case, these mothers do not stay in the hospital for a long time. Immediately, they want to go home. So they have not learned anything, including breastfeeding also. Otherwise, ideally, they should at least learn the technique of breastfeeding. And we should make sure that they are able to give oral breastfeeding and then discharge. I believe Rajasthan has introduced this obligation. But we have to now learn from that. And but most of the mothers are leaving. In that case, our health workers should be now oriented to offer some home-based care, kangaroo care also to these babies. Home-based newborn care should include kangaroo mother care. And third group is still there, whether we acknowledge it or not, home deliveries are occurring. And they are not able to come to hospital for many reasons. Some states are there with still today, 50% deliveries are occurring at homes. Meghalaya and Arunachal Pradesh and Chhattisgarh and so many states are there. And even in our state, many times we find more home deliveries are occurring than reported. in that situation also, sometimes Kangaroo Mother Care may be the only life-saving intervention. That also has to be acknowledged. So our health workers have now to be tuned for that. Next one, please. So in deprived situation, every baby gets the same benefit. But the perception, how you feel the priority, in different sections where no access to hospital care is there, our health workers have stimulated them and it has become the life-saving thing. I got so many case studies, 600 gram baby, and delivered in the hospital, but because it was low birth weight, doctor did not even see, discharged them, went home, health worker advised them, till the baby leaves, at least continue breastfeeding and kangaroo care. Today, the baby is living for 12 years, doing very well in schooling and everything. And like that, 1.1, 1.2 kg, 900 gram, 820 grams, so many examples we have got. Middle income group feels it is a cost-saving method. And even higher income group, where the cost is not the consideration, facilities are not consideration, but there, and they have a lot of helpers. Even then, we promote kangaroo care because they perceive the quality improvement in terms of better brain growth. Not only the neuromotor development, neurosensory development, and behavior development. It's a comprehensive neurodevelopment which is occurring. Next. And now in COVID time, many things have already been told. So I just want to say, we want to promote breastfeeding and we want to promote kangaroo care also because of the two reasons. Our fear is COVID positive mother, whether she will transmit her infection to the baby. But now we have learned, even though the mother is COVID positive, very few babies get COVID positive status. And many times it is because of the horizontal transmission. And even if the baby gets real COVID positive problem, then also many of these babies have only mild sickness and they improve very fast. So with all this consideration, at least as on today, our experience with COVID is limited. Tomorrow we do not know whether they have got any teratogenic effects and other things. But at least as on today, weighing the risk of COVID transmission to the baby and problems and the benefits of non-separation, early skin-to-skin contact and the kangaroo mother care, now we have promoting this. And I am glad we started this quite early. At that time, we did not have many reviews, but now WHO, everybody has reviewed. And last time on 15th May, WHO, it was the world theme that even during COVID era, you promote kangaroo care. And of course, you have to decide it on individual case-to-case basis, depending on many other considerations. Next. So, and another thing, many times all the mothers are not tested. They do not know their status. And now that we get lots of reports that people are becoming positive. So when in doubt or when there is a family contact, we say treat them as if you have got COVID positive. We are not threatening them, but we are just giving them precautions. So you decide depending on your area and depending on your convenience, depending on your confidence that you treat. Yes, mother and baby can be all the time together. Mother can, even if mask is not there, even then she can practice. But if at all there is some suspicion or some doubt or some anxiety, you treat the baby as if you have it. So promote good hand washing, promote the mask use, and promote surface contact. There is no harm done, but at the same time, do not threaten them or do not separate the mother and baby. Next. So, and just as you are treating for the prevention measures for the mother and baby, health workers also have to be told. Here we have shown those who are in the hospital, community health workers also will have to be trained now for all the infection prevention measures because these COVID warriors are now becoming victims. So that also we have to minimize. And sometimes because of the threat, they don't go home, they don't properly train them. So that also should change. Next. So all this I have already said. So infected newborns also, mostly they are non-symptomatic or mildly sick and they recover fast. So all this sometimes we have to explain, especially to the family members who read only the newspapers and they get the panic syndrome. So a lot of counseling is required. Next. Next. Okay, the same messages I have given, and during transport we are then. Now I can stop here, I think. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam. Thank you so much.
COVID, do not separate the baby and mother. Do not prevent them to having skin-to-skin contact, kangaroo care and breastfeeding. Thank you.
Madam needs a standing ovation for such a wonderful lecture.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
All the panelists agree with me. No? Madam spoke so well, so fluently. Thank you, madam. Thank you. It was worth all that.
Yes. It comes from the heart.
I only request, I have learned few techniques from you, but at the same time, we do conduct some more workshops, some more training programs, so that the quality of care is also there and the scope is also, coverage is also improved. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Any questions?
Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, there are a few questions is by audience. I have selected five most relevant questions.
Only one more question. I just wanted to clarify one thing about what Dr. Joshi had said, that no salt and sugar till 2 years of age. But there are different opinions on this. What BPNI Maharashtra and Indian Academy of Pediatric believes is that after 6 months they introduce food, salt and sugar can be used, but not extra salt and sugar.
Right.
Yeah, because otherwise, you know, even shira without sugar will not taste good, or any other material without salt, so infant may not take interest. So definitely extra salt, extra sugar, and junk foods, which obviously contain more salt and sugar, should be avoided. So one has to remember that there are two opinions, but in India, as far as the official organizations like the IEP is concerned, they say no extra salt and sugar.
Personal experience also says minimum sugar or salt, definitely it is useful. I would put it even one step ahead, not only not harmful, but useful. Extra salt and extra sugar should be avoided. That is
true. Yes, ma'am. Ma'am, we'll take up a first question. So there is Dr. Vinod from Mumbai, who is asking, what is the type of container to be used when we are practicing home milk banking?
Jayashree, are you around? Jayashree, madam?
So there are various types of containers that can be used. To a considerable extent, it depends on the type of pasteurizer you're using. If you're using a shaker water bath, then we generally go with containers. So you can use even glass or you can use polypropylene. But if you're using a fully automated pasteurizer, which is, especially if it's an imported pasteurizer, then it has to be polypropylene.
Okay.
They generally come specific to the pasteurizer.
Okay, ma'am. The second question is by Dr. Tilak Raj from Delhi. He wants to know about products like Lactiva, which has any role in increasing the milk secretion.
Lactiva, I believe, is Shatavari or Satavirix. What is Lactic? Anybody knows the content of Lactiva? I think it is. There are a lot of products available with some herbal preparations, but the best known product is Shatavari, or say anything that contains Shatavari, like Satavirix and other products. I'm not taking any particular company name. There have been controlled trials. The senior most obstetrician in Mumbai, Dr. B.N. Purandare, had conducted trials, and it is found to be effective traditionally also and scientifically also. So yes, after assessment by a lactation counselor, if the milk is really less, then for promoting the more milk production, it can be given. It has been used traditionally in India for routinely given to all lactating mothers, and we have not found any extra engorgement or side effects caused by that. So if mother likes it, it can be given. But about other products like fenugreek and other things, we are not really sure. But Shatavari is the only thing I would talk about.
Sure.
But the most important thing will be counseling. And of course, watching for the position, attachment, almost in 99% of the cases, we are able to rectify these problems. Because once we mention one product, immediately people jump on to many others also and claim. So before that, of course, they may have some role, I don't deny. But best thing is complete emptying of the breasts. And that happens with proper positioning and proper attachment. That has to be made sure first, and then go for that. And doctor, everybody doesn't have a lactation counselor. So the doctors have to know this part. So I would personally prefer this.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you.
You can start the category and say, everything is done. We don't need to do anything else. That is
no, but many times they just jump on to Shatavari and they don't do the previous steps.
And actually, mother may not have less milk. She may have enough milk. She may have engorgement also.
Right. In fact, majority of the cases, that is what is happening. We require a little patience and observe the mothers closely.
True, very
true. Okay. So the next question is that this is by Dr. Ankita Jain from Kalyan, who is asking that she is a mother to an 11-day-old child and the baby sleeps after bath for 6 to 7 hours. So is that gap okay for breastfeed, or should she's asking, should she wake up the baby to feed in between? So baby is sleeping for 6 to 7 hours after taking bath.
Yeah, Munkal madam.
Well, I look at it this way. Since the baby is only 11 days old, I'm a little concerned. If it was, you know, but I'm still, I'd like to know more details about the history. So babies have what is called cluster feeding. So they may feed frequently for something and, you know, so they make up. So normally you expect a baby to feed at least 8 to 10 times in 24 hours. So that is being achieved even on day 11, that's fine. But otherwise, if the frequency of the feeding in the whole 24-hour period is less than eight times, I would worry a little bit. Once the baby, you know, is growing well, we've documented that the baby has crossed his birth weight by 15 days of age and is growing well, then I wouldn't mind if the baby slept for 7 hours and then caught up with his feeding throughout the day. But at 11 days, this is what I'd look at. We'd also use the usual test that we look at, that we say that, okay, how much is the urine output within 24 hours? Is the baby passing urine at least 6 to 8 in a 24-hour period? And I think very important is how many times the baby is feeding in the rest of the time.
That is more important.
Feeding, then, okay, I wouldn't worry. But if, like, the feeding is hardly 4 to 5 times in a 24-hour period, I would worry.
Okay. Okay.
Take, you know, consultation from an expert.
But at least generally, I would just like to re-emphasize that waking up the baby and feeding is not a very good practice. Only if baby is going to sleep, provided the baby is otherwise healthy, not getting any medications, which might be leading to that. So once in a while, let her sleep for 5 hours, no problem.
Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, the next question is that, what is the effect of breastfeeding on milk quantity and quality according to the lifestyle of mother?
Kashiwani, madam?
No, Prashant can answer this.
Prashant? Oh, I don't think so. When I take my lecture, I will say Indian mother, foreign mother, of any caste, period, whatever, all of them produce same amount of milk. It is the attitude which is important. And how much it is a mother and how much is the education. So that may make a difference. But otherwise, mothers are mothers. So I won't differentiate between her lifestyle and her goal. Her goals are more important.
Lifestyle nowadays is, if they're Googling more, they get worried more. And that affects. That is the only thing I would
say.
Ma'am,
do you see that stress has any role on the milk production? If the mother is stressed out for some reason, then certainly the milk production will be reduced.
It may reduce, but it could affect the oxytocin production.
Yeah.
Oxytocin is the feel-good factor. And so oxytocin could be affected. And therefore, that's why it's support at all levels, family level, mother, mother-in-law, sibs, neighbors, everyone have to be supportive.
Very supportive. True, ma'am. Ma'am, I'll be taking up a last question. The doctor is asking that a child who is not breastfed, he or she may develop a low immunity. So in such situation, would you recommend any supplement for the child so that he can improve his immunity?
Best supplement is mother's milk.
Best supplement.
We try and push. One should push towards supporting this mother and actually getting her to refeed again.
Okay.
Madam, before you close, one comment I would like to make about a previous question. I know we are getting out of time. Dr. Armida Farnandez, who established the first day, had asked me this question, Prashant, why you are recommending in 15 days to wake up the baby? Don't you feel it is unnatural? So I told her that cloth has been invented by human beings. The babies are supposed to be in close skin-to-skin contact, monkey care or kangaroo care. From the time of birth till at least they are 15, 20 days or sufficiently old. So we have done one mistake of wrapping the babies up when they're supposed to keep in skin to skin contact. So to negate that mistake. We have to do another mistake of, you know, removing the clothes and giving them skin to skin contact. So if you're wrapping them up and sleeping for 7 hours, like Dr. Jayashree says, she would be concerned. I would also be concerned. So I would, in first 15 to 20 days, recommend to the second mistake of, you know, removing clothes and trying to wake them up to cover up for our first mistake. So two negatives will make positive.
Okay, another concern is, of course, if the baby is otherwise healthy, please allow them to sleep. Only if there is some other concern. And they, on empty stomach, nobody sleeps. Yeah. Remember that.
Yes. True. Yes,
and
ma'am.
Of course, they can stretch another half an hour or 1 hour, but they will wake up. Preterm baby is extremely well. Of course, naturally, you are going to monitor many other things.
Vaishali, I have a comment.
Yes.
Before sleeping, before bathing, they must be giving something which makes the baby sleep. Listen. If a baby does not bathe and does not sleep, then sleep is the problem.
Yeah.
I mean, sorry, I'll carry. Bathing is the problem. Okay. Number one, I'm not against bathing, but there is something happening pre-bathing that makes the baby sleep.
In many communities, they have the habit of giving a little bit of
morphine,
balagoli, opium and those things.
And we used to get babies with opium poisoning.
Yeah, true. Sir, what is your opinion regarding balagoli, sir? Like, does it help, or what is your opinion on that?
Prashant. All questions to Prashant, unless proved otherwise.
Because if I am wrong, my two seniors would correct me. I have nothing against traditional medicine. But as far as first 6 months are concerned, I would say that no balakadi, balagoli, whatever. After 6 months also, I would not recommend it as an allopathic doctor. At the same time, not downing traditional medicine. We don't know what the effects are unless they are properly studied. Beyond 6 months also, I will be very concerned about this
product. Here, one concern I want to say. National TV, earlier we had stormed this Woodward, Gripewater and so many advertisements. Now they are all again coming up. I would request BPNI people to take it in a big way. So this
we
is
all will, we thing. All will, we all will.
There is no role for all these things. Role is mainly for counseling and advising them about the proper technique of giving feeding rather than any of these medicines. And personally, at least we have found, we are able to rear many of the babies without any of these things.
The question is to everyone, is there anything which you want to make it a point or a note to the audience?
Breastfeeding is the best. Breastfeeding is the best.
Yes, ma'am.
I just wanted to say something about this balagoli and gripewater. Many parents give it despite what you say. So if it doesn't harm, I feel we should allow them, because mother-in-laws and other family members will, you know, somehow give it anything.
Yes.
I want to tell a message that whatever good we learn, we have to tell in 1600 Indian dialects and use social media and reach it to everybody, because 70,000 babies are born every day. Unless you teach 70,000 new people, the pool of ignorant people will keep growing.
True, sir. Yes, sir.
What I would like to give is that the breastfeeding and complementary feeding is a science. Though traditional and natural, it is a science. So if you don't consider science, people have different opinions. That's why different pediatricians files have different recommendations. So please try to respect it as a science and then talk about it.
Standardized, correct.
And another state
babies in hospital
in all the cases
breastfeeding, milk banking and kangaroo mother care.
So in all the cases we may not say this gripewater and all are not doing harm, because they are giving gripewater, they take late advice and they go for further problems. Anyway, my message is only thing: start with early skin to skin contact, continue for a longer time. Even the doctors, I request them, and of course it includes promotion of breast milk also.
With this, I would like to extend my vote of thanks to all of you. Firstly, I deem a great honor to extend my vote of thanks to everyone who are involved to make this webinar a resounding success.